Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to your Ryan Favors A1 Combat 12.
These boxers sanctioned are regulated by the California Amateur Mixed Martial Arts Organization. Your chief inspector and timekeeper, Brandy Hoskins. Your ringside physician for our amateur bouts, Dr. Gary Furness. Your judges scoring the contest at cage side, David Shirley, Wayne Phillips, Brian Tyler, and Randy Silva. And when the action begins, your referees, Wayne Phillips, Randy Silva, and David Shirley. This show is presented by Firepower Promotions, Uriah Faber, and UFC Fight Pass. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention to the American flag located on the screen. The privilege of this event has been made possible by those who have fought and continue to fight at home and abroad in the various branches of our military for the freedoms we all enjoy. Let us now honor and respect their efforts and our country. We ask you to please remove your hats. All veterans, we encourage you to render the appropriate salute. Everyone able, place your hands over your heart for the playing of our national anthem by the Finland Brothers. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, the Finland Brothers. All right, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our first fighter to the cage, Juan De La Rosa.
All right, Corey McKenna, everybody welcome in. It is Jim Cooley, the voice of champions, along with my broadcast partner for the prelims, UFC strawweight Corey McKenna, Corey Poppins, as they call her. We're going to start this show out with a catchweight 195-pound fight, Corey, and Juan De La Rosa is making his way to the cage.
Yeah, debut fight for Juan tonight. He is fighting out of Torres y Muay Thai, so I'm sure, you know, we've got a lot of their fights on the card tonight, so I'm sure he had plenty of preparation leading up to this, and a very Muay Thai-esque walkout for him tonight, so I think it's not going to be much of a surprise as to what to expect.
Absolutely. I mean, this guy's a stand-up fighter for sure, training with Iggy Zambrano over, at, as you said, at Toro Z. Tonight, he makes his MMA debut. And both these guys had a little bit of a tough time cutting weight, So we moved their fight up a little bit heavier, and they were both happy about that. So now we get the heavier weights.
Yeah, I did note that his opponent is moving down from light heavyweight. So naturally, like you say, would assume that it's a bit different cutting that, like, that weight division is a very big jump, you know, especially at amateur. But yeah, like say, if they're both happy with it, that's great.
Absolutely. So this is our first Pro-Am card, Corey McKenna. We've done some Emmy events under the Firepower name. This will be the first Emmy show as A1 Combat. And as such, our seventh fight here tonight, Nico Colunga and Andrew Toasty Tosti will be fighting for the first ever A1 Emmy belt.
Yeah, it's very exciting to see a platform allow opportunities for all styles of fighters. You know, obviously the amateurs, the upcomers, it's going to feed into the pros for us. This fight tonight, the first one on the card kicking off, is a two-minute round fight, my apologies, you know, because both guys are just starting off their career, but 2 minute rounds tonight here, Jim, I was just saying, and yeah, it's great for them to have that platform to really build their career and go through the ranks with A1. You know, it shows that you can take people all the way here. They're making their amateur debuts, they're making their pro debuts, they're moving on and they're moving through the ranks of A1, so it's a great platform for everybody.
Absolutely, and we've already sent some guys to the UFC. Peyton Talbot, our pro bantamweight champion, will be fighting on the Contender Series very soon, picked up by the UFC. Hopefully he can do well there and move up. And like you said, we bring them in as debuters. They fight on the Emmy show, move to the pros, make their way up the A1 rankings, and hopefully to the big show.
Yeah, exactly. And it's just a testament to the level here that we're putting on display and the fighters that we are putting on display for you guys watching at home. You know, and I feel like tonight's going to be no different. It's going to be, from the looks of it, a very entertaining card.
Yeah, we've got some good fights. I'm not going to lie. I match made the Emmys. It's the first time I've match made a card. So I'm super pumped to see how it works out. And as Juan De La Rosa enters the cage, let's send it up to Garrett Fortig to bring out his opponent.
And his opponent, Ignacio Ureno.
And here comes Ignacio Ureno. He fights out of Ant Dogs MMA. And they've got a couple guys on the show here tonight as well. De La Rosa is 1-1 in his amateur campaign. His last fight came back in February of this year, where he was unfortunately KO'd by Jakiah Price. Prior to that, he picked up a third round knockout himself over Alexander Lee back in October of 2022.
Yeah, I haven't seen too much about Ignacio, but as you say, both his win and his loss came via knockout / TKO. So, I mean, on paper, I'd say this guy's the type of guy that's going to go out there and leave it all on the line. So really excited for this fight tonight. Both guys look really pumped up, and it's really exciting to be hosting these amateurs tonight and able to see, you know, all different levels of this sport.
Absolutely.
On display.
And Ant Dogs MMA, of course, we talked a little bit about that A1 Emmy title that'll be the first one we give out. His teammate, Andrew Toasty Tosti, will be vying for that belt here tonight as he takes on Nico Colunga. But right now it's about the 195-pound division, the cruiserweights, if you will. This gentleman is ranked number 66 in active amateur light heavyweights, is Ignacio Ureno. 6 foot tall for him. Both these guys need a win. Obviously, the debuter has never even been in the cage. He needs a win. And, of course, Ureno coming off of a loss recently in February. So he wants to pick up a win here tonight as well. Let me explain a little bit to you guys at home that are A1 fans but have not seen the Emmy yet. You'll see that some of these guys have shin pads on. And as I do that, let's check out the tail of the tape. Juan De La Rosa, 26 years old, pro debut here tonight, 195.8 yesterday at the weigh-ins, 5'9" tall. 3 inches taller at 6 foot is Ignacio Ureno. He is 193.3, 1-1 in his campaign. He is 32 years old, the senior in this fight. As I said, you'll see the shin pads in some of these fights, 2 minute rounds. And as the guys get a little bit more experienced, they'll have 3 minute rounds with no shin pads. Corey, let's send it up to Garrett for the official announcement.
Good evening and welcome to the Hard Rock Live for your Ryan Faber's A1 Combat 12, streaming on the A1 Combat YouTube channel. We kick off our amateur prelims with a 195-pound contract weight bout set now for 3 2-minute rounds presented by Fanslow Governmental Affairs. Find them online at fanslowga.com. And now introducing first, the Legacy Farms Blue Corner. Standing 5'9" tall, weighing 195.8 pounds. Tonight he makes his amateur MMA debut, representing Toro Z Muay Thai. He fights out of Sacramento, California, Juan De La Rosa. And now introducing his opponent across the cage, fighting out of the Legacy Farms red corner. Standing 6 feet even, weighing 193.3 pounds. With a record of 1 win, 1 loss, he represents Ant Dog MMA and fights out of Gilroy, California, Ignacio Ureno. Your referee, Randy Silva.
Randy Silva gets the call here tonight. And it is the red trunks for Ignacio Ureno, the black trunks for Juan De La Rosa, making his debut here tonight, as we alluded to. They're going to open up the show. This will be the first ever A1 Combat amateur fight. So these guys will make history right here tonight in Uriah's company. And of course, Tom Anderson, the man behind the company, putting all these shows together with Uriah and team.
Yeah, and touching what you were saying about earlier with the amateurs, Jim, obviously the fortunate thing with amateurs is it's all experience, because at the end of the day, once you turn pro, your slate's completely wiped clean. And for them to have the ability to do it on a show like this, they get the total feel of being a professional with that, whilst gaining the experience of an amateur. And I think that's great for the individual themselves. You know, we've got the large crowds, we've got the lights, the cameras, like, A1 is the real deal, and it's a great experience for the amateurs to compete in front of that.
Absolutely, and if they can start out here like De La Rosa is, then when he moves to those little bit smaller amateur shows, he won't have any of those butterflies in his stomach.
Split stance here, you know, we've got one southpaw, one orthodox. Obviously, for the southpaw, that liver kick is there, which we did just see. I thought that hurt him, but he's back in it. For De La Rosa, that is, obviously, Ureno landed the liver kick.
Ooh. Left hand followed by a right uppercut from Ureno. Lands another left hook after that. Again, Ureno in the red, De La Rosa in the black. De La Rosa wants to lock up now, which is strange because he is from the striking academy, Toro Z.
Yeah, and I feel like, you know, Ureno looks a lot more... Ooh,
nice
beautiful lat toss there from De La Rosa.
He gets side control. He's going to try to... It looks like he's going to try to mount a little too soon. He's up against the cage. I like to see a guy get some position first, but it did work out for him.
Yeah, he did a good job of settling his hips. Obviously, Ureno has the cage that, scooted his hips out as I speak. You know, he scooted Ureno's hips away from the cage, so that's going to make it a little bit harder for him to wall walk and start working up here. So honestly, like, great fight IQ from De La Rosa here. You know, he was struggling a little bit with the range. He was getting hit with some shots from a distance, and he chose to clinch up and take the guy down. So, you know, a beautiful display of fight IQ for De La Rosa here, given that it's only his debut amateur fight.
Absolutely, and it's nice to see the kickboxer from the kickboxing academy get that nice takedown and achieve mount.
Yeah, I think that's just a testament to the sport. You know, a lot of people aren't one-dimensional anymore, as you would expect. You know, he came out in the Muay Thai getup, had us thinking he was going to be a striker, and here he is with great positional awareness.
And I got to give that first round, although the bigger shots were landed by Ureno, it was very short and sweet. And on top, most of that round was Juan De La Rosa. And if I'm judging this fight, I've got that fight 10-9 right now for De La Rosa.
I personally think Ureno might have edged it purely based on the fact that judges these days do tend to look more towards significant strikes. And although De La Rosa, like you say, did a beautiful lat drop, had the control time, I do wonder if they will favor the damage of Ureno, but definitely a close round. I wouldn't want to judge it. You know, these two-minute rounds are hard to judge because there's such little time for action to happen.
Yes. And we're going to take a look at some of the action that went down. Here comes the takedown. Now, you look for a leg trip right there, did Ureno, and Juan De La Rosa used his momentum against him, and nice toss. Gets side control, as you said. He settled in his hips a little bit, and then he immediately went knee on belly and went for that full mount. Little cage grab there that the referee missed, but it didn't affect anything.
Yeah, and Ureno here, he's making the mistake of holding the head, which we talk about a lot. If you're holding onto your opponent that's on top of you, all you're doing is holding yourself down. So I think that perhaps shows a little bit of situational, like, unawareness for Ureno, but interesting to see what's going to happen in the second round.
And speaking of the second round, Randy Silva brings them to the middle. Here we go. Round number 2, 195-pound catch weight. De La Rosa, Ureno, first AMI A1 fight. Airing here on YouTube.
De La Rosa looks a lot more composed this round. I think, obviously, like you say, it's his debut. That first round, he's got it out of his system, and I think he's shown the proven to himself that, you know, he is ready for this. So he looks a lot more composed going into this round. Oh, that head kick wasn't nice, though. Yeah, I think De La Rosa is struggling a little bit with Ureno's range. That wasn't the best shot there.
Ureno, nice sprawl right there. He's going to go for his back immediately, though. You see some good grappling again from De La Rosa, but now Ureno ends up on the back anyway.
Yeah, great exchange from the guys here. Some scrambles, you know, Ureno got a bit overambitious on jumping the back and got reversed, but immediately, you know, he ducked out the back and he reversed the position. So great situational awareness here, and I believe.
Well, you know, De La Rosa threw a nice elbow from the front, but unfortunately that's illegal in camo. So.
Oh, goodness.
CAMO, of course, is the California Amateur Mixed Martial Arts Organization. They will sanction tonight's AMI prelims. And CSAC, California State Athletic Commission, will sanction our professional bouts.
De La Rosa is doing a great job of initiating scrambles. You know, he's rolling out the position. He is able to get Ureno off balance. I just feel like he needs those second or third phases to follow up to actually fully escape. Like, he seems to do this, and then he settles, and then Ureno's back on
top
again.
If you look, though, Ureno looks to be the much bigger and stronger fighter. So after he's used a little bit of that energy, De La Rosa, then Ureno just uses his strength. Now listen, these fights will get stopped quicker than the pro fights will later on this evening on UFC Fight Pass. Because it's an amateur fight, and as I say that, here comes Randy Silva to wave it off. Ignacio Ureno will pick up his second amateur victory here tonight by TKO in round number two with just 16 seconds remaining. De La Rosa was a game opponent. I really liked his grappling and his scrambles considering he comes from a Muay Thai academy.
Yeah, I think he did really well tonight. You know, like I say, that lat drop was perfect. The timing was perfect. It does show that he definitely has the skill set. I just think, honestly, I think the positioning would have been a lot different if he just, like say, had those second and third phases on those scrambles and didn't kind of accept the positioning. And I thought that gave Ureno the opening to get back on top. But again, for your amateur debut, I think there's a lot to take away from that. And I think he did a lot of things very well also. And at the end of the day, as we talked before, it is just experience.
Absolutely. And let's take a look at some of the action that went down in this fight. And here you see Ureno just throwing the hands, and that's the end of the fight right there. Randy Silva waves it off. And again, if this was a pro fight, that probably would not have happened.
Here's the thing, De La Rosa, he was sprawled out on his stomach. He wasn't really doing much to fight up in the position. Yes, he was okay, but he was taking damage. And as you say, it is early in the amateur career. And as I said, he wasn't positionally advancing. You know, he was sprawled out, his legs were straight, he was flat on his belly. That's not a good position to be in a fight.
Absolutely. And let's get this official decision underway with Garrett Furtick, the voice of A1 Combat.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Randy Silva has waved off the contest officially. 1 minute, 41 seconds of round number two. Declaring your winner by TKO, Ignacio Ureno.
So Ignacio Ureno, as I said, technical knockout, picks up his second victory in the amateur ranks. They'll give it a little huggy time there and a little respect.
Yeah, and you know, that's two finish wins. Obviously, his losses by finish two, so he just continued that trend. You know, he showed great composure in there tonight too. Given that he's only had two amateur fights, I think he did. You know, he did extremely well of staying composed in there and wisdom beyond his experience. You know,
absolutely. Coming up next, guys, it is going to be Derek Moon and Tavius Hunter, and they are in the welterweight division. Another 3 2-minute rounder. You'll see those shin pads for another three fights. And then we'll move to the no shin pads and the 3-minute rounds, getting these guys ready for the pro portion of their career. We're gonna try to fly through these prelims for you guys here tonight. Garrett Furtick will make his way back into the cage. And we will get started with our next bout.
Ready now to make his way to the cage, Derek Moon.
So here comes Derek Moon, Jim West prodigy. Jim West out of MMA Gold. And here comes Derek Moon. Now, Derek Moon obviously training with studs over there at MMA Gold, and Jim West, trainer of champions, of course, coach of Aspen Ladd and Fluffy Hernandez and all those guys over there that are big-time fighters in the UFC.
Yeah, and, you know, Derek is 1-0. His last fight was in February with Firepower, you know, obviously another local show linked to A1. And he actually since had a Muay Thai fight in March that he won. So, looking to round out his skills from the looks of things. And yeah, I'm excited to see what he has in play. It's a very high level training where he's at. And excited to see the momentum here. Another 2-minute round fight, as we mentioned earlier, as he is only 1-0 and his opponent is only 1-1. I believe it's 3 fights when you lose the shin pad.
Yes.
And you move up to a 3-minute round.
Absolutely. And his win that you talked about here at Firepower Future Stars, which was the precursor to A1 Combat, was over Mario Aldana, who won that by unanimous decision. And then, as you said, he went on to win his Muay Thai fight by split decision. He had a canceled bout against Ethan Morales in between those fights, and this will be his third fight. He has yet to taste defeat in any combat sport that we know of, Corey McKenna.
Yeah, and I love to see that from the amateurs. You know, I talked a lot of the amateur guys that I work with and train with, and also myself when I was an amateur. Now's the time to get that experience. You know, if you lack in your Muay Thai, go away, do some Muay Thai matches, like do some boxing matches, compete in jiu-jitsu. Like, now's the time to really hone in your skills and work on every aspect. So I like to see that from Moon.
Absolutely. And let's send it up to Garrett to bring out his opponent, Tavius Hunter.
Set now, his opponent, Tavius Hunter.
So Tavius Hunter from Headhunter MMA, he is 1-1 as he comes out here to take on Derek Moon tonight. Actually, Tavius Hunter, it appears actually he's 1-2. He fought at 559 fights back in 21 and also had another fight in 21, both of which he lost. Then he had to cancel bout, came back and picked up a unanimous decision win in Central California in November of last year. And since then, he's had a couple more canceled bouts and makes his way here to Uriah Faber's A1 Combat tonight.
Yeah, so one of the things that you'll notice with Tapology and then, like, obviously the fights, obviously we're saying that he's 1-1. That is because those are Camo-sanctioned fights that he has had.
Right.
Camo only recognizes fights that they sanction. Obviously, they want to regulate, keep things safe, keep the athletes safe. But there are plenty of organizations that don't run things through Camo. So sometimes the records might be a little different on Tapology, which we'll probably see often tonight. But yeah, like, that doesn't say anything like bad about the promotions. Just like say, we are a camo run organization. And yeah, one thing with Tavius that I noticed is that I thought was quite curious. He has fought at middleweight, welterweight, and lightweight before. So clearly a guy that's using the amateur time to build the experience, kind of see where he sits in the divisions. And like I say, I just love to see these guys getting this experience, especially on such a show as A1. I think it's really great for their careers, and it's a great path for them to follow.
Absolutely, and this should be a really good fight. 22 years old for Derek Moon, 23 for Tavius Hunter. 1-2 for Tavius, 1-0 for Derek. Derek is 157.8, 5'10", and 158 pounds. Not much difference there, and a 1-inch height advantage for Tavius Hunter, who comes in tonight at 5'11" tall. Garrett Fertig, bring him out.
A1 Combat now moves to the welterweight division for our next bout, presented by Richardson Fire Protection, a full-service fire protection company that offers leading solutions to all your fire protection needs. For more info, go to richardsonfirepro.com. We're now ready to go 3 2-minute rounds. Introducing first, the Legacy Farms Blue Corner. At 5'10" tall, his official weight, 157.8 pounds. At 1-0, he represents MMA Gold and fights out of Loomis, California, Derek Moon. And now introducing his opponent across the cage, fighting out of the Legacy Farms red corner. At 5'11" tall, weighing 158 pounds. With 1 win and 2 losses, he represents Headhunter MMA and fights out of Fresno, California, Tavius Hunter. Your referee, Wayne Phillips.
So Wayne Phillips gets the call, and Tavius Hunter and Derek Moon, and the red, white, and blue stripe down the side belongs to Derek Moon. He's also got the blue tape on his gloves, and the black with the red trim belong to Tavius Hunter. He's got the red tape on his gloves, and time to get it on. Here we go. And immediately, Derek Moon slipped. I don't know what he slipped in. You have to wonder if maybe the last team left some water in the cage, but Derek Moon went to run out and actually slipped, and Tavius Hunter immediately took advantage of the situation, Corey.
Yeah, and you can't blame Hunter for that, you know? I mean, everything goes in a fight, near enough. But great job from Moon to work up to his feet. He did a great job pummeling underhooks and being aware. Unfortunately, he's in this guillotine, and that looks tight right now. Oh.
And you don't see a lot of pros get guillotined, but you do see a lot of Amis get guillotined. Tavius Hunter looking to finish this, but he's going to let go of it.
He did a great job of staying calm in that position, fighting the hands. I'm actually very impressed with Moon to make the most of that adversity, you know?
And he changed levels right there too, Corey, and got underneath, and he at least got one underhook out of that.
Yeah, like you say, he stayed calm, collected. He made it out of that bad position, and now he's controlling Hunter against the cage. Hunter's doing a good job at pummeling that underhook. So he's making it difficult for Moon, but, back on that guillotine. He needs to be careful of his neck. He keeps leaving his neck in there. You know, he's doing a great job of fighting the hands and everything, but he's still cutting it pretty close.
Tavius still, like you said, looking for that guillotine. Halfway through the round, big shots coming in from Tavius. Derek Moon trying to regain his composure after slipping at the beginning of the round. And changing levels this time was Tavius Hunter looking for a single, and instead Derek Moon ends up on top with a good scramble.
I'm very impressed with Moon's reversals here. You know, he's very aware situationally, and I feel like he really does, like, even though he ends up in adverse positions, like in the guillotine or like he slipped, he's doing a very good job of staying calm and working out, and it's just showing like the level that he clearly trains at, like we talked about before with MMA Gold. He seems very comfortable in those bad positions, which for the amateur experience that he has at 1-0, I think is a huge testament to his training, because a lot of people would freak out. You know, someone's grabbing your neck, you're gonna freak out.
Right.
You're on the bottom, you're gonna freak out. Like, it's amateur, you're not used to being in these situations.
But like we said, Derek Moon training over at MMA Gold with all those UFC pros, he's probably caught in that position more than he would like to be. And Tavius Hunter ends the round on top. I've gotta give that round to Tavius Hunter. All the submission attempts, the big shots, the takedown. It sucks for Derek Moon that he slipped. But, you know, it happens. So let's take a look at this now. Here we see Derek is going to slip.
Oh.
And I don't know what happened. It looked like he was running, changed his mind. I don't see any moisture on the canvas.
Yeah, so. I mean, the last fight, like those big boys sweat. So maybe there's a little sweat
Correct.
Left from the last fight that we missed. What we'll see is Tavius did a great job at the end of that round with that blast double. He drove straight through him into the cage. And I'm very impressed with both guys for the little experience that they have. Obviously, Tavius is coming in here 1-2. You know, he obviously doesn't want to go 1-3.
Right.
So I feel like there's definitely some urgency on his behalf. But I'm very impressed with the composure of Moon for being in those adverse positions and still staying calm, collected, and working his way out.
Absolutely. And you saw Jim West with the Max Payne Griffin shirt on. Another UFC fighter from these parts. There's a lot of you guys out here, Corey McKenna.
Yeah, there is.
And gals.
It's growing. One of the things I will say with these two-minute rounds, which was unfortunate, you know, like he made a little mistake or he had an accident, he slipped, and that eats up a lot of the round with these two-minute rounds. There's not a lot of time to work at this low-level amateur, which does definitely sway the direction of the round.
He gets a do-over here, though, Corey, but he's going to end up in the same guillotine attempt that he was stuck in the first round. And this time, Tavius has him on the ground, and he's got his guard up, too. This could be a position that he could finish him. I can't quite see from this angle, Corey, if he's got it locked in.
Moon is doing – he has it in, but I don't believe he has his hands locked. Moon is doing a good job at stacking and controlling the hand. I personally am terrible for it, so I'd be a hypocrite to say he shouldn't leave his head in at all, because, you know, that's actually one of the reasons I got that Von Flew in that fight, is
right.
because I knew she was going to grab my head, so I gave it to her, which probably drove everybody I know crazy, because – if it gives me the takedown and I know how to defend it, I'm okay with it. But I'm very impressed with Moon and his positional awareness here. You know, he managed to escape the guillotine. He's controlling Hunter now. And, he's got that wrist strap, I believe, on the far side. Can't quite see from this angle. Yep, he's got that wrist strap. That's going to be really difficult for Hunter in this position. You know, his back's to the cage. He's got the wrist strap. He's controlling that bottom hip by sitting in that half guard.
This is the most dominant position that Derek Moon has had thus far in this fight as well. And now he's gonna look for the back. He's got one hook in, he's got two hooks in. Can he flatten him out? He's only got 41 seconds. And this looks really deep.
Honestly,
and
with these amateur
fights. Wayne's gonna take a look.
Yeah, I think that might be it, you know.
He's only got 30 seconds. No, it looks like he adjusted and he's let go.
With these amateur fights, I feel like he would almost benefit from letting go and just unleashing a barrage of strikes.
Not a bad idea.
He's got him flattened out, and as we saw in the last fight, if you're flattened out and you're not advancing your position and you're eating strikes, the referees will step in, because at the end of the day, we don't want to see these amateurs taking unnecessary damage early in their careers.
Right. Tavius doing a good job, though, trapping the hands of Derek Moon so that he couldn't throw punches. And what happened was, as he finally got them out, Tavius rolled to his back really quickly. to avoid getting rained on from behind there.
And Moon is doing a great job at riding the hips here. You know, like he turned over, he took the back, he turned back, he took the mount. Like, he's doing a very good job of controlling that top position, which is a huge part of jiu-jitsu that people don't realize. It's not all submissions. Like, it is predominantly positional awareness and being able to control your partner. And that takes your partner, your opposition, my bad. I'm talking about training. But it takes a lot of skill to actually be able to control another human being that is fighting for their career.
And let's take a look at some of the action that went down. This is toward the end of the round here. And you can see Tavius doing everything he could to hold on to the hands of Derek Moon. And Derek lands some big shots there, but immediately said, okay, look, I can take his back. I'm going to get my right hook in. I'm going to get my left hook in. I'm going to flatten him out. But like you said, Corey, it might have behooved him more to land those shots because in the AMI divisions, they like to stop these fights a little bit earlier as you're getting hit a lot from behind.
Yeah, and with submissions, like, it's going to be tap or nap, as they say. Like, you can fight a submission longer than you can fight getting, like, well, you know, hit, like, several times. Like, the referee's going to see you getting punched. They're going to give you a little bit more lenience with the chokes and with the submissions. Just because, as I say, like, it doesn't cause as much damage. And you don't have as much time to allow them to sit in those positions. You'd be better off just trying to finish the fight.
Absolutely. And here we go. Round number three. Little jab there from Derek Moon. Tavius eats a right hand as well from Derek. And they one underhook in for Tavius, one for Derek. Knees coming in from Derek Moon. And he is the one up against the cage.
Yeah, and I have to assume going into this that we're looking at a round apiece. So, you know, they have 1:40 to really sway these judges and steal this fight. You know, like I say, Tavius is coming off of, you know, he's 1-2, I believe, was 2 losses. And I feel like he really needs to do something now to pull the trigger. He can't just be hanging out in guillotines like this. Because, as we said, you're just eating up time, and you don't have much time to work in these fights. And Moon has done a great job of showing his ability to defend these positions. So honestly, I would have rather see Hunter try to keep it on the feet and land those strikes, or at least be the one to take the top position as opposed to jumping on the neck and allowing himself to end on bottom.
You hear all the fans giving out instructions. Not that you necessarily want that. You want to try to hear your corner. Derek Moon on top, half guard, quarter guard, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, and this position's great for Moon. He is cage side. Oh, as I say, they obviously change position. But if you are cage side against your opponent, you are essentially putting a block between them and the tool that they will use to stand up if you're on top. And same with here. You know, Moon is in the center of the cage. It's going to be hard for him to get up here because he doesn't have a cage or something to lean against and use to wall walk. Looks like a cut on the head of Hunter there. Do you see that?
I do. He's been bleeding for a while, and the blood that you saw on Derek Moon, I believe, came from Tavius Hunter. I was trying to make that out, but yeah, that's what I was thinking as well.
He ate that straight to get in, but great job from Moon. You know, he's insisting on getting those takedowns. That's where he had the success in the last round.
He's got to do something, though, about keeping his head up when he shoots in, because he's gotten caught in that guillotine several times. You get a guy that's really good at that guillotine, and Derek's just going to hand it to him, and he needs to kind of change that up a little bit.
Yeah, and that's a hard fight to score, essentially. I think we went around a piece moving into the third, and that round was kind of hard to tell, really. Each guy had control. Each guy ended up on top. I mean, Tavius had the guillotine attempt, so if they're looking at attempts to finish the fight and submission attempts and stuff, maybe it edged him, but honestly, I'm not 100% sure, and I would want to call how the judges are going to see this fight.
Well, let's take a look back at some of the action they're going to be forced to judge here. This is Derek Moon on top in that half guard, trying to land some hammer fists. He lands a couple of shots to the side of the temple of Tavius Hunter. A couple of those went errant to the back of the head, and that's just, you know, a product of Tavius turning his head. There's a big right hand from Tavius Hunter. As you said, he ate that on the way in to get that position, but he also ended up in another guillotine attempt. Luckily, it was short time. He was able to get out of that. That was an arm in guillotine from Tavius. And now it really all lands in the hands of the camo judges.
Yeah, and like we say, amateur is just experience. Like, obviously, you expect your amateur team to make mistakes. That's why they're amateurs. So, you know, I think both guys did phenomenal tonight for their experience. And as you say, like, Derek can go away, he can work on his guillotine, leaving his head in, and it's all stuff. It's all great experience for his team to look at and build on and make those adaptations before they move into the pro ranks.
Absolutely, and these guys are going to need to turn around for the announcement of the winner. They are facing the wrong direction. Looks like they're going to get him inside there. So here we go. Let's bring Garrett into the cage, I guess. He's waiting for the decision. So once Garrett gets that decision, he will hop on in. And like you said, Corey, this is a tough one to judge. So it looks like it's going to take a little bit more time. They're going to double-check those scorecards. And the only man right now who will know will be Garrett Fruitig, the voice of A1 Combat. Coming up next, guys, Donald Todd, Mason Hartshorn. I stand corrected. Christian Alba and Gabriel Marquez will fight next in the bantamweight division. And that should be a barn burner as well. We've had some good fights so far. Who match made this fight? What a great fight this was.
I know. He did a pretty good job.
I like it.
Oh, here he comes. Is Garrett for the decision.
Yeah, we're going to turn these guys around. And Garrett will direct traffic in there. He knows what he's doing. And he's going to give us the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of action-packed action, we go to your three judges at cage side for the decision. All three judges, Brian Tyler, David Shirley, and Randy Silva, all see it the same, 29-28 for your winner by unanimous decision, Tavius Hunter.
So the crowd doesn't like it, but keep in mind we're in the 916, and Derek Moon is from the 916. Tavius Hunter will pick up his second amateur victory in as many fights as he moves to 2-2 in his amateur career. And Derek Moon, for his part, picks up. Go ahead.
Sorry, I was going to say, I think that's one of those fights to where I think someone was going to boo either way. You know, it was a close fight. I can see why they gave it to Tavius Hunter, and I definitely don't think I would argue it personally, but as you say, we're in the hometown, and I think either way it went, somebody was going to be unhappy tonight.
Right. Tavius Hunter picks up his victory, but Derek Moon, for the first time in his career, whether it be Muay Thai or MMA, has picked up a loss, and that's something that I think everybody needs to, you know, experience at some point in their career as they grow as fighters. Tavius super happy to pick up his win here at the Hard Rock Casino Resort Sacramento at Fire Mountain. A1 Combat brought to you by Tom Anderson and Uriah Faber, UFC Hall of Famer. And it is the Kudo Corral. Shout out to Kudo sponsoring tonight's event. You can see them in the center of the cage. Kudo is protein popcorn. Make sure you guys check that out. And we will be at Tachi Palace in just a few weeks for Uriah Faber's A1 Combat 13, and then we head down to Southern California for Uriah Faber's A1 Combat 14. And in between, in September 9th, we will have a Muay Thai show, our second A1 Combat Muay Thai show. So it's going to be a great night of fights, guys. Don't forget our main event of the evening. Andrew Coyne will put his A1 Combat featherweight title on the line against Ernie Juarez.
Yeah, and as you say, a busy year ahead for A1. It's great to see the promotion growing and also, as you say, supporting different styles, you know, Muay Thai fights. We've had submission grappling fights on here before. We've got amateurs, we've got pro. It's just really showing that Uriah Faber's A1 Combat is really growing and also embracing every aspect of the sport, and it's a great promotion for people to get involved with.
Yes, absolutely. And we're going to get Garrett into the cage and get this next fight started, I hope, here pretty soon. All right, guys, we are waiting for the ringside physician to make his way back to the cage. Dr. Gary Furness, legend out here in the MMA community. And, yeah, guys, don't miss all the action. Hit us up on Instagram at A1 Combat. You can find us on Facebook, Uriah Faber's A1 Combat. We are out there, guys, and lots of good stuff happening with Tom Anderson and Uriah. They put together these fights, and as I said, a match made the Emmys. And Tom Anderson, by the way, promoter extraordinaire, match made the pro card here tonight. So these pro fights that you'll see on UFC Fight Pass, by the way, if you don't have UFC Fight Pass, you'll need to get it now so you can watch the rest of this show after the amateurs. But Tom Anderson matched those fights, and that should be pretty good as well.
Yeah, that's really exciting. And a little trick for you guys at home, if you're not already a Fight Pass member, they give you a free trial. So no excuse to not watch tonight's show.
Yeah, because if you stick around on UFC Fight Pass, you can watch some of Corey McKenna's fights.
Exactly.
You can watch you. They can go back and watch you do the Von Flute choke. What fight was that? Tell them.
That was August. So that was a fight night card. I don't remember. It was August 8th. I can tell you that much. And
you got to get it together, Corey McKenna. You set a record that night. You need to know when it happened.
I'm gonna start walking around with it, like.
So as Garrett Fertig just notified the crowd here at the Hard Rock Casino, we're waiting for the doctor and the commission to make their way back to the cage.
Yeah, and like you say, the priority here is our fighter safety, you know, so getting these doctors back, and like you say, with the amateurs, the early stops and everything, like, I feel like it's a true testament to A1. They're really putting their fighter athlete safety first, and yeah, although it's a little inconvenient to have that little wait, but it's definitely great for the fighters.
Absolutely, and coming up next, guys, it is two debuters. Christian Alba will take on Gabriel Marquez. And that is two debuters making the trek here tonight to the Hard Rock Casino Resort. That is a bantamweight bout here, and that will close out our early prelims. We will then move to our prelims. And you see Kayla, Kimber, and Whitney, the A1 Combat Ring girls. And that, by the way, is Uriah Faber's daughter.
The Cali Kids Kid.
That's right, the Cali Kids Kid. And her name is?
The Boss Lady, Cali.
There you go, Cali. That's right, the Cali Kids Kid, Cali. That's a tongue twister right there.
Yeah, exactly. He didn't help himself.
I think she's a better dancer than Kayla was.
I mean, Kayla's cute, but Callie, I mean, she steals people's hearts every day.
And I'd say Kayla's not a good dancer, but she was going to be a Raider girl, so she could probably dance pretty good. And you guys make sure you check out the exclusive A1 Combat gear. You can find them on Instagram at A1 Combat Gear, I believe is exactly what it is. If it's not, you'll see the link on our regular A1 Combat Instagram. Saturday, September 2nd, we make our way back to the Tachi Palace. September 9th, it is A1 Muay Thai. And then we will make our way down to Southern California, back to the Commerce Casino for a great night of fights down there.
Yeah, as you said about the next fight, you know, two debut fighters, one guy is independent, which obviously means we don't know too much about him, unfortunately. We don't really know where he's training and what he's doing. So if anything, that adds an element of surprise and a little bit of excitement going into this fight. And then we have, you know, Gabriel Marquez. He's out of Toro Z Muay Thai. We saw his teammate fight earlier. We talked about that, obviously another debut guy. Unfortunately, he lost, so I'm sure Gabriel's going to come out here and, you know, try to cheer up the mood a little bit for his team, but
yes,
like I said, his teammate did very well, and I'm excited to see what he brings to the cage tonight.
Absolutely, and he is not. Oh yeah, this will be the last Toro Z Muay Thai fighter of the night for Iggy Zambrano and his squad over there. There you see Ed Colantis. Herb Dean will be in the building here tonight. That, by the way, is Melody Colburn and her husband John Kersey. They are at every single event in the front row. They are big supporters of A1 Combat, and they do not miss a show.
Oh, Garrett.
And Garrett Fertig, ready to go. Let's do it.
Now ready to make his amateur debut, Gabriel Marquez.
Gabe Marquez, as you said, out of Toro Z Muay Thai with Iggy Zambrano. And again, we don't know a lot about them to talk about. But again, debuter here tonight. And this is it. I mean, your first fight as a mixed martial artist. You're walking out on this giant stage at the Hard Rock Casino and making your way down the stairs into the Kudo Corral, as it were.
A very confident walkout from Marquez. You know, like say, it's his debut, and as you were saying, with the lights and the crowd and everything, a lot of people do get a little bit hesitant up there. So he looks very confident walking out tonight. His fight name is Too Smooth. You know, I'm excited to see if that correlates into his game tonight.
Listen, Corey, what do you think about a guy having a fight nickname when he's never fought? How do you feel about that? I know you pick up some nicknames in the gym, but you should have to have a couple fights. Listen, I love Iggy. I love that whole team. That's Iggy right there talking to him right now. And I love Gabriel. He's a good guy. I was working with him to set this fight up. But I think you got to wait. You can't have a nickname until you fought a couple times.
I mean, I think it depends. So, I mean, where I've trained, fight names are earned, not given.
There you go.
Sometimes some of the best, like, gym guys just don't fight. I've had plenty of friends that are amazing training partners, and they don't fight, or, you know, their skills don't transfer over to fighting. So I feel like it's not always about your fighting. But also, a lot of the times when it comes to fight names, we never know. Too Smooth could be completely unrelated to MMA.
There you go. Hey, this guy could have the best game in the world and just be able to pick up any chick on the planet. I shouldn't say chick. By the way, you guys don't say girl and guy. What do you say over in your part of the country?
I say guys.
You don't say lads? Don't tell me you don't say lads.
I don't say lads, but most of my friends do, yes.
And for the
you
girls,
lads,
what is it?
Lads and lasses.
Lasses.
That's more Irish and, like, the Scousers, I'd say. But, I don't know. Everyone's mate to me.
Everyone's mate? You've never called me mate. Now I'm not your friend anymore.
I have once because you called me out on it.
Oh, okay.
I think it was the last show.
Well, I'll call you out on it again if you do it again.
All right.
So in the cages, Gabe Marquez. Garrett Fertig will now bring out his opponent.
And now we welcome Christian Alba.
Christian Alba, independent fighter. And this kid, let me tell you something. This kid wanted to fight, Corey. As I was setting up this card, Christian Alba was like, look, man, I want to fight. I've never fought. I want to fight. So how do I do this? And so I walked him through the camo procedures. They messed up his physical. This kid drove 2 hours to go pick up his physical. They messed it up again. He went back and did a second physical. I mean, this kid, he was like, I want to fight. What do I have to do? I don't want to mess this up. He was in touch with me all day, every day. And all he could say was, I don't want to not be able to fight. What do I need to do? And I really like to see that effort out of these young kids because so many fighters you deal with are like, oh, I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it tomorrow. This kid couldn't wait to get his stuff done so he could get in this cage here tonight.
Yeah, and that's a great testament to himself. Like you say, a lot of people aren't as proactive, especially with the amateurs, as you say. Like, I've heard plenty of people be like, oh, I'm an amateur. I'll get on it when I'm a pro. But, like, to see somebody that's actively chasing their goal and chasing their dream, like, that's admirable regardless of what happens tonight. Obviously, like you say, we don't know much about him. He's an independent fighter. On the nickname front, he calls himself, I'm going to assume he calls himself, as he's an independent fighter, the Skywalker. So I'm definitely curious as to how he got that for tonight. But no, I'm very excited for this fight. Like I say, two debut guys, a great matchup on paper. Like you say, both guys with no experience looking to move into those amateur ranks and obviously eventually up to pro, and they're doing it, as you say, on a huge stage for A1 Combat. They've got the lights, the cameras, the crowd, and for them to even be able to show up today, that is a huge testament to themselves at this level of experience.
Absolutely. With the nickname Skywalker, he better run up that cage like Pettis and show me something. Otherwise, look, man, again, we've got more nicknames out here for these debuters than we did for the guys who've had fights. Let's check out the tail of the tape. 24 years old, it is pro debut, 135.5 pounds for Gabriel Marquez. He's 5'10". So is his opponent, Christian Alba, who weighs in just a pound over. This is a very closely matched fight, both pro debuters. 20 years old for Alba, just 4 years younger. Garrett Fertig, let's get it started.
Live from Sacramento, California, A1 Combat now moves to the bantamweight division, brought to you by Tetrit Construction, a California-based construction company with over 135 years of experience. Find them online at tetrit.com. We're set now for 3 2-minute rounds, introducing first the Legacy Farms Blue Corner. At 5 feet, 10 inches tall, his official weight 133.5 pounds. Making his amateur MMA debut, he represents Toro Z Muay Thai and fights out of Sacramento, California, Gabriel Too Smooth Marquez. And now introducing his opponent across the cage, fighting out of the Legacy Farms red corner. At 5 feet, 10 inches tall, weighing 134.8 pounds. Also making his amateur debut this evening, this independent fighter fights out of the Bay Area, introducing Christian the Skywalker Alba. Your referee, Randy Silva.
Too Smooth versus the Skywalker, and they're both debuters. The red kick pads belong to Christian Alba. The black kick pads belong to his opponent, Gabriel Marquez. Randy Silva will make sure the gate is closed, make sure the judges are ready, and we will get this party started. Third fight of the evening. We've had two great bouts, including our last bout that went to the distance.
Oh.
Alba moves in quickly with those shots.
He is not wasting any time. We've got those 2-minute rounds, and like you say, he seems to be capitalizing on that, making the most of it. He hasn't got much time to work, and clearly he knows that.
Now listen to this, though. All that energy he's expending, all these lights, as we talked about, being in the big show, his first fight ever, independent fighter. How much of an adrenaline dump is this guy going to get out of this round if he's able to finish Gabriel Marquez in round number one? Grabbing the cage is Marquez. Randy Silva's taking a check over there to make sure he lets go.
I love the aggression of Albert here. Like you say, he was desperate to fight tonight. He really wanted to get in there, and I feel like he's really trying to capitalize on this opportunity.
Oh, but he just ate a big, he got poked in the eye. He got poked in the eye, but the referee didn't see it. And it made him mad as he lands a big right hand, big left in there, swinging, and down goes Alba.
Jesus.
And all of a sudden, a fight has broken out at the Hard Rock Casino.
Yeah, sometimes that aggression, you know, it can really work for you or it can really work against you. And I feel like he got caught coming in angry. Great job to back out there and create some space. Looks like he is going to make it out of this round, but a beautiful exchange from both guys. Definitely the more skilled fighter for Marquez, I believe. Oh,
big right hand. I'll tell you what, I do not like the way that Gabe Marquez has his mouthpiece hanging out of his mouth this early in the fight. He's clearly already breathing heavy. If Christian Alba can weather this storm, I think you're going to see a very tired Gabe Marquez in round number two.
Unfortunately, I feel like when he was stood in his corner, he had the similar thing with his mouth guard. He probably has one of those boil and bites, which I do not recommend for any fighters. If you like your teeth, please don't fight in a boil and bite. It's just not good for you.
Big right hands coming in from the top right there on Gabe Marquez. And Alba's in
open guard. I definitely think Marquez has stole the round here. I mean, Alba came out swinging. I mean, not necessarily with the best technique. He is angry walking back to that corner, and I think he's going to come out hot the next round, just as he did this round. But a great job from Marquez to stay calm and collected in there. You know, he got hit with some pretty big shots in there. So testament to both guys and their chin.
And let's take a look at the replay here of a very action-packed first round. Big right hand there from Alba, as you said, very excited. Big knee and a big right hand right there from Marquez, but it was a poke in the eye, and you could see the thumb got him.
It was the thumb, okay. I wasn't too sure if it was the edge of the glove. Sometimes you get hit, and like the edge of the glove will catch you, and you feel like it's an eye poke, but unfortunately to the ref, it looks like a punch. But no, that's unfortunate. Like we say, we've had a couple of accidents today. Like say, the ref didn't see the eye poke, the last fight the guy slipped, but great job from both guys to be able to keep fighting and keep pushing through and make the most of the situation.
Absolutely.
I think that was a close round. Honestly, Alba came out so strong that perhaps it swayed the judges just based off of the amount of time he had as the aggressor. But also we have Marquez who ended up on top and did steal the later end of the round, which is sometimes the last things that the judge sees, so can sway them that way. So I think it'll be really interesting to see how that round was scored.
Absolutely. And here we go, round number two. And I want to see if Marquez is indeed tired. His hands are still up. Both guys look fairly fresh. Big right hand there from Alba, but he's reaching for those punches. Kind of what Ronda Rousey did against Holly Holm, and that got her in trouble. You don't want to reach for those punches because when you reach, you're also sticking your chin out there.
Yeah,
unprotected.
I'm not 100% sure this fight's going to go the distance. Both guys are getting hit with some solid strikes. I mean, I think it's smart from Alba to be engaging in these grappling exchanges. You know, he got caught a little bit in the last round. And he's doing a great job here of controlling Marquez, which is obviously, like I say, a very different direction than we took in the first round. He seemed pretty angry in his corner, so it's nice to see him not come out quite so hot and open and getting hit with those shots unnecessarily, which I think comes with experience. You know, it's his, as you say, it's his debut. He's not been in here before. He's not felt the emotions. He's not felt the, you know, the adrenaline, the pressure. And getting hit in a fight is very different to getting hit in a gym.
Oh, absolutely. Because they're swinging full force.
Yeah.
And people are watching and your ego gets bruised. Ooh, oh, nice.
Great reversal from Marquez there. And he's got 45 seconds to work here. I mean, I would say he's down for this round for the most part. Obviously, like I say, that's 1:15 that Alba ate up being on top.
Right. And he's still got to do something from the top, does Marquez. There's a left, but Alba gets out of the way and is able to stand up. Yeah. Alba walking away with this round unless something changes drastically here. But I think, I know, Gabriel Marquez had to have won round number one with those knockdowns.
Yeah.
And now he's going to knock him down again. Oh. He's going to finish him. Randy Silva's going to stop this fight.
We spoke too soon. I did say I didn't think that was going to go to the distance. Both guys landed some solid shots in that fight. You know, and I think both guys can be really proud of their performance tonight. Debuts, probably one of the most exciting fights we've had so far tonight.
Absolutely, great fight. Both guys came to scrap. As I said, Christian Alba was ready to fight, so was Gabriel Marquez. And Gabriel Marquez showed up, showed out, and picked up the technical knockout victory in round number two here tonight at A1 Combat.
Yeah, and honestly, obviously, Albert's disappointed in himself. Everyone is after they lose a fight. But you see, it's your debut. When you turn pro, your amateur experience doesn't really impact too much. And I think he had some great exchanges. We're looking at here. You know, he landed some solid shots, but he did get caught.
Big right hand, and there's the finish right there. So the right hand hurt him, but the left hand looked like it almost put him out, Corey. And that's when Randy Silva jumped in and stopped that fight.
Yeah, Marquez did a great job at dropping his weight behind that punch. And, you know, Alvarez, as you say, he left himself open with his aggression, which, like I say, aggression is great in a fight because you're in a fight. You know, you've got to want to hurt your opponent, but it can't be at a detriment to your technique and to your skill set. I feel like he left himself open to get hit because he was so eager to get that finish, you know? So I think moving forward, just a little bit of composure from Alvarez, and I honestly think that could have made a huge difference in this fight because he really did have some great opportunities and landed some solid punches. So I don't think he should be disappointed in himself tonight. Once he watches this back and, you know, moving forward in his career.
Yeah, absolutely. But Marquez picks up his first amateur victory. Alba's not happy, but he should be happy because he actually... he actually put on a great show here tonight. Sorry, we had to stop. It was picture time with Shannon Newton, the official photographer here tonight of A1 Combat. Garrett Fertig is in the cage. He has the official decision. We are just waiting on the winner to make his way to center cage. And Garrett will tell us what we already know, but he'll tell us in a much prettier voice.
Ladies and gentlemen, Randy Silva calls off the contest. 1:39 of round number 2, declaring your winner by TKO, Gabriel Too Smooth Marquez.
Too Smooth Marquez.
Yeah, and I just wanted to be known on stream. I did just get a smile and a double thumbs up out of Jim Cooley, so hey. I think he's going soft.
No, I'm actually, like, I don't even remember doing that. I don't find that to be true at all. The Backpack Boys are in the building, though, it looks like.
And who are the Backpack Boys?
You got to Google it. Listen, Corey McKenna, if you're
going to
be pop culture, listen, everybody at home, Google the Backpack Boys with Z. I'm not going to explain it. I'm going to tell you why I'm not going to explain it. I'm busy. I'm commentating fights. I'm doing things here at A1 Combat, Corey McKenna. I have a lot on my plate. I cannot explain pop culture to you. What I can tell you is coming up next is Dominic Hidalgo and Henry Ganzorig. And Dominic Hidalgo, one of the biggest ticket sellers here tonight at A1 Combat 12, sold a ton of tickets, so he should have a nice following here at the Hard Rock Casino Resort Sacramento at Fire Mountain. Shout out to Kudos Protein Popcorn for sponsoring tonight's event. And Garrett Fertig is center cage to bring out our next fight.
And now we welcome Henry Ganzorig.
Let me tell you a story about Henry Ganzorig before we start talking about his fight career, because I like this kid a lot, and I'm going to tell you why. So we had everyone checked in, all the fighters, the Emmy fighters checked in, and everybody was doing their thing and signing their contracts and getting their pre-fight medicals. And Henry Ganzorig texted me and he said, "Hey, when do I need to be there? I'm eating." And I said, "You were just here." And he said, "Yeah, I left to go eat." And I go, "No, you need to be here." So then we started the rules meeting. I texted him. He didn't answer. So I called him. He answered. I said, "Where are you?" He said, "Chipotle." I said, "Did you get me anything?" He said, "No." And I said, "Then get your back over here right now." But anyways, Henry Ganzorig decided that he was going to go eat while everybody else was doing all their medicals. It's only his third fight. He's a good kid. I really liked working with Henry leading up to this fight. His opponent switched on him twice. And he ended up fighting here tonight, Dominic Hidalgo. He is coming off of a victory over Brandon Silva, December of 2022. And that was a third round knockout for Henry Ganzorig. And I look for big things from him here tonight.
Okay, so Henry Ganzorig is an independent fighter, so as we spoke back in the last fight, that doesn't give us too much background on him. But, you know, like, the matchups tonight have been amazing, so I'm sure that he's going to come in, he's going to bring it, and he's going to continue the tone for everybody here tonight.
Absolutely. He's got a tough opponent out of Team Black, Dominic Hidalgo. And Dominic Hidalgo is a stand-up fighter. And this should be a good fight. As you said, Henry Ganzorg unaffiliated. But this kid is very calm, probably the calmest guy I've seen here tonight. Let's send it up to Garrett.
His opponent now making his way, Dominic Hidalgo.
And by the way, the reason I told that story is to let you know that he was unfazed. He was like, I'm going to go get something to eat. I'm good. I'm calm. He's just relaxed. Henry Ganzorg is relaxed. Dominic Hidalgo, Antioch, California, Team Black, making his way to the cage. And this kid sold a ton of tickets. And if you look to your left, Corey, they're all standing up. And they're all ready for Dominic Hidalgo. And this should be a great fight. Dan Black assures me that this kid can go. So when you got the most confident, calm, relaxed fighter on the card against the guy who sold the most tickets on the Emmy portion of the card, and this should be a good one.
Yeah, definitely. And as you say, like, with Henry, like, not much experience in terms of actual amateur career, but to be able to be so calm and composed before a fight, that's a huge testament to your, like, not just your experience, obviously, in the cage, but also, like, outside. Like I say, a lot of people get the adrenaline, the jitters and everything. I actually used to nap before my fights. I still try to. So I think being calm and composed going into a fight definitely pays off more to, in comparison to the last fight where I talked about the aggression being a detriment because sometimes you leave yourself open and you think with your emotion as opposed to your fight IQ.
Right.
So it'll be interesting to see, you know, if that pays off for him or if that Chipotle is a little bit too heavy in there.
And in the corner of Dominic Hidalgo, of course, is Dan Black. And in the back, you see Sauce Marley right there in the Heart Smiley shirt, one of the most decorated amateur fighters out of the Camo organization. He was also Cali Fights Magazine's 2022 Fighter of the Year. And he has just moved to the pro ranks. We will see him in Los Angeles as he makes his A1 combat debut as a pro. And that should be awesome. Sauce Marley, look for him. All that bullying on his wrist and his neck, and he's not even a pro yet, Corey.
Hey, sometimes you gotta fake it till you make it, you know what they say?
Dan Black applying the Vaseline. It looks like Randy Silva said too much. Dan Black maybe was in the corner of George St. Pierre when he fought Nick Diaz. Speaking of Diaz, Nate Diaz and Killshot Nick Coring on their way to the building as we speak. They will be joining us here tonight at the Hard Rock Casino Resort. 209's finest, one of the most famous fighters in the world, who will soon fight Jake Paul in a boxing match.
Yeah, and like Dominic Hidalgo is 1-0. You know, he last fought in February, so not too long of a layoff or anything for him. Be excited to see if he can continue that tonight, that winning tonight.
Absolutely. Let's check out the tail of the tape. 1-1 for Henry Ganzorg, 165 pounds. He is 5'10", 2 inches for Dominic Hidalgo, comes in at 6', 164 pounds, and 1-0. Everything very close in this fight. Let's send it up to the man, Garrett Fertig.
Hey, one cop, I would like to remind everyone to subscribe to UFC Fight Pass to continue watching our main card beginning at 8 p.m., where the A1 Combat Strawweight and Featherweight Championships will be decided. A1 Combat now continues our prelim schedule for 3 2-minute rounds in the welterweight division presented by Hoffman's Excavation. Introducing first, the Legacy Farms Blue Corner. At 5 feet, 10 inches tall, weighing 165 pounds. His record stands at 1 win, 1 loss. Fighting independently, he fights out of Berkeley, California, Henry Ganzorig. And now introducing his opponent across the cage, fighting out of the Legacy Farms red corner. Standing 6 feet tall, weighing 164 pounds, with a record of 1 win, no losses. He represents Waffle House and Team Black. He fights out of Pittsburgh, California, Dominic Hidalgo. Referee Wayne Phillips.
Dominic Hidalgo in the black scrap pack trunks. Of course, Dan Black used to be the kickboxing coach of Nick and Nate Diaz. They are all very well intertwined out there in the 209. And scrap pack, Gilbert Melendez, all those guys, Jake Shields. And the black trunks with the blue trim belong to the very relaxed Henry Ganzorg, who wanted to touch hands. Dominic said no. So Ganzorg jabbed him, and Dominic responded. And Ganzorg looks for a takedown.
Yeah, beautiful toss there from Ganzorig. Very composed. You know, he got hit with a stiff jab. Like, obviously, he wanted the glove touch, but Hidalgo said no. He was straight to business. He's in on this double leg now. Being just beautiful.
Look at that punch right there from Hidalgo from the bottom. Yanzorig was looking for, it looked like maybe a Kimura, but not going to be able to do that. He's just going to take damage right now.
Yeah, and he needs to be careful leaving his arm under there. He's almost in like a crucifix position to take damage. Great job for him to get out there. But he's holding the head. We keep talking about this. Like, guys need to stop holding people onto them, especially in these short rounds where they're just taking damage, because the referee's going to jump in, or they're just going to lose this round because they're holding a person on them. Unfortunately, with these short two-minute rounds, you've got to fight for your life to get out of those positions.
At least you saw there, Corey, he tried to use it to reverse the position. It just didn't work. He's got the wrong leg. He needs to roll him the other way if he's going to try to take him out of this right now. So he tried to roll to the leg that was posted.
If you have the half guard on that position, on that side, he needs to be swimming his right underhook as opposed to his left in order to start working out the back, or even just shrimping his back to the cage to use that to wall walk up, as we talked about earlier. Right now, he's just on the wrong side of the body, like upper body-wise. He's holding onto him, and he's not really utilizing it to get up. He is stopping the damage off Hidalgo, but that's not going to win him the round.
And right now, Hidalgo continues to land body shots, and I'm sure once we see the other side of Ganzorg's body, there's going to be a lot of redness and tenderness, landing some shots to the temple there. On top, Dominic Hidalgo, Team Black, extraordinaire.
A lot of damage here from Hidalgo. You know, this is definitely not a questionable round. It's not close at all.
No.
And he's doing a great job of controlling position here.
And Corey McKenna just got her clothes delivered by Hector Fajardo.
Oh, no, that was my dinner. He already delivered my clothes.
Oh, your dinner.
I got him trained well.
Look at this. I mean, he's bringing you dinner. He's bringing you clothes. He's kissing your forehead. You guys must have just got married or something.
Yeah, you know.
Take a look at the replay. Corey McKenna, of course, married Hector Fajardo, fighter here at A1 Combat. There's those big shots coming in from Dominic Hidalgo, and the big shots to the head as well.
Great job from Hidalgo here to swim his head to the inside, if you notice. So he had more control of the position, and also he was able to win that head fight position. He kept head control on Gonzorig's chin, and that allowed him to land more damage and kind of negated the holding down position that Gonzorig had.
Right.
By swimming his head inside, like you say, it negated that position.
And I'll tell you something else that I just noticed. Not only did he take damage, but he's wearing damage. And you can tell by, look at the damage to the side of his body, the damage to the bridge of his nose. He's bleeding. And that's the problem. He's very pale skin. He's very fair. And what happens is you see the redness and you see the damage, and that works into the judge's thought process. They see you wearing damage and they actually take that into account. Not that it would have mattered, because he won that first round, decidedly did Dominic Hidalgo.
Yeah, but that's also got to put some hesitancy in him moving forwards. You know, his nose is bleeding, his ribs are beat up. Hidalgo was not holding back with those strikes, so he has truly felt his power at this point, and he does look more hesitant moving into this round, because I can guarantee you he does not want to feel it again.
Hidalgo's last outing was February of this year. He picked up a decision victory over Mario Aldana. And Ganzorig lands some good shots there, and switching to a double leg takedown was Hidalgo.
Yeah, he ate two hard overhands, but he also gave two of his own. So, you know, he's not out of this fight, not counting him out, but great fight IQ from Hidalgo here to, again, see, he took him down, he swam his head to the inside, and now he's just going to land damage on top. Honestly, I could see him finishing it. Oh, armbar! His elbow's out, he's safe. Great job from Ganzorig to give him something to worry about and threaten something, just even to save himself from that barrage of punches that was coming up. That was a really good job on his part to throw up that armbar, threaten Hidalgo and slow down the pace of the fight, even just for a split second. He did it again. He's leaving himself in those armbar positions by being overzealous with those punches. And yes, we want to finish fights, but we do still have to be aware that our opponent is never out. You know, Ganzorig's doing a great job of throwing up submissions, threatening him, giving him something to think about. And now all I'd like to see is for him to use this to work up, or like I say, like if he had that armbar position, the elbow got past, use that to create space and start working up here. But a great job from him to stay active on bottom as opposed to just taking damage like with the last round.
Absolutely, 30 seconds left in round number two, welterweight division. This is our fourth AMI fight of the night, three to come. Mason Hartshorn, Donald Todd will get it on next. Laquan Jenkins plays Proffer in our co-main event of the evening. And, of course, that title on the line, Nicholas Kalunga and Andrew Tosti, coming up just before the break, before we move over to UFC Fight Pass. Thanks for joining us, guys. Jim Cooley, the voice of champions. Corey Poppins McKenna, UFC strawweight holder of many records in the UFC, including shortest reach. That's always my favorite.
I think that's one that's never going to get taken from me. You know, I used to be the youngest, but I'm getting old.
Yeah, you're getting really old.
Yeah, I turned 24 last week, so.
Yeah. You are literally half my age. Literally half my age. I'm 48.
I like to tease Uriah. He's a year older than my mother, so he will never live that down.
Let's take a look at some of the action from that round.
I definitely think this was a lot better round from Ganzorig. Obviously, he still lost it, but he did make a few adjustments. Unfortunately, I think it's a little bit too late.
He looked for the armbar there. At least he was trying to throw up some subs.
Exactly. The throwing up the submissions to at least delay the damage that he was taking.
Right.
I think that was very smart on his part. He did a great job at, like, you know, shifting his hips to throw up submissions. He had his feet on the hips to create space. I just think there's a couple of positions where he's perhaps not too experienced in that. I feel like if he closed those gaps, it would make a huge difference to his game.
And by the way, the Backpack Boys are in the building to watch Dominic Hidalgo fight. He's got one of them, I believe, in his corner, so.
And for those of you at home that are still wondering who they are, because
Google
Jim Cooley is too cool to tell us, we Googled it. They are, Instagram people with 78,800 followers. I'll be looking more into it when I get home, but apparently they're kind of a big deal.
Nice jab there from Henry Ganzorig on the way in. Ooh. On the entry. Nice shots, though, coming back from Dominic Hidalgo. Coming out of that kickboxing camp of Dan Black, and as I say that, he throws a nice high kick. And Ganzorig, I don't like that Ganzorig's hair gets in his eyes. He needs to do something with that before he fights. I don't know what you could do, maybe braid it up or something, but he's constantly having to get that hair out of his eyes.
So, fun fact, when I was 16, I thought that it would be way more efficient to cut my hair. And in growing out, I also had the Justin Bieber-esque haircut.
So oh, wow.
Definitely an inconvenience for fighting.
You could look a little like Justin Bieber if you cut
your hair. I did. Everyone used to ask if I was in a boy band.
Sing me some music.
Great job from Hidalgo here to put the fight back to the mat. You know,
yes.
He's winning this fight.
Absolutely.
I would hate to say easily. You know, he's still got caught in some submissions and everything, and I don't ever want to talk down on another fighter, but he has really dominated the fight in this position.
Oh, absolutely.
And Ganzorig has shown that he has some large gaps to close, but he's still an amateur, and now's the time to do it. So definitely a great learning experience for him in this position. And he landed some hard shots on the feet, you know. The only thing that I really saw is he's going wide with a lot of them. They're very looping shots. And Hidalgo's staying very calm and hitting him through the center and with those head kicks because he is a little bit wild and inexperienced. I think that's all it comes down to, really, with the guys with this sort of record and at this point in their career. It's inexperience, and it's something that they'll rectify when they go home. And by the time they hit the pro ranks, they'll be completely different fighters.
And fun fact, both of Ganzorig's last two fights went to round number three. In one of them, he was TKO'd in round three. In the other one, he landed a TKO in round three. So he's not a stranger to round three. But if someone gets knocked out here, he's keeping his streak intact. But it's not going to happen. Just under 8 seconds to go here as David Shirley looks on. And Wayne Phillips, the referee. And one more takedown for the road for Dominic Hidalgo. You come out of a kickboxing camp and you get a ton of takedowns and work from the top to dominate this fight. In my opinion, 30-27, if not 30-26 for Dominic Hidalgo.
Yeah, I mean, there's no question with that fight. That was a very dominant and composed fight from Dominic Hidalgo, which, as I keep saying, I'll probably say this for the rest of the amateur fights, but, you know, that composure in there is very hard at this level. And I just think that's a true testament to, like you say, his preparation, his team. And I think he can be very proud of himself tonight. Obviously, everyone wants finishes, but I think he did a great job in there to just control the entire fight and just show his full skill sets. You know, he had success on the feet and success on the ground, and he caused damage. I think he can be very proud of himself tonight.
Absolutely. Carol, the cut woman, was in the corner of Henry Ganzorig cleaning up all the damage that was done. There you see her. All the damage that was done by Dominic Hidalgo here tonight. Ganzorig, it's a learning experience. Just three fights into his very young career, and Dominic Hidalgo will thank the man upstairs. And there is Dan Black, the founder of The Feast over at Team Black. And really good outing, as you said, from Hidalgo here tonight. And it's good. I mean, he's got a ton of fans in the crowd. He got on the card last minute. We were trying to match him. Weren't able to do it. Finally found Ganzorig. He was game. And Hidalgo, for his part, showed up and showed out. But you know what? Ganzorig lasted three rounds. So he is not out of this fight game yet. Just a little bit of work to do, as Corey said, on the ground, maybe figuring out how to get out from underneath the guy when he's on top of you. And that's a big part of this game. So Garrett Fertig makes his way into the Kudo Corral for the official decision. Wayne Phillips will bring them to the center.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of action-packed action, we go to your three judges at cage side for the decision. All three judges, Brian Tyler, Randy Silva, and David Shirley, see it the same, 30-27 for your winner by unanimous decision, Dominic Hidalgo.
So as we expected, Corey McKinnon, we didn't go too far out on a limb with that one, but 30-27 across the board for Dominic Hidalgo. And it was a great fight. Uriah Faber walking through with the family, and he's got some Kudo popcorn with him as well. And he will be joining us later on for the pros, or he maybe looks like, maybe Uriah's gonna join us right now.
Yeah, and leading on from this fight, obviously it does beg to question, these independent guys, they come in here and they give it their all, they give it their heart, but you know, these guys are coming out of elite camps now. And I do wonder if perhaps these independent guys would benefit from seeking out a team and seeking out some structured training to improve their skill sets, you know? So like, say this is experience, they're gonna go away and they're gonna rectify things. And I just feel like you need the right people around you to give you the tools to do that.
All right, guys, I was a little distracted. Uriah Faber came in with his entourage and made a big scene. So I like this song right here. I heard Coco County. I don't know what that's about. Shannon Newton in the center of the cage right now. If you guys want to check out her photos, she'll be giving them over to us. Tom Anderson, the founder of the Feast.
I'm just glad Uriah brought my favorite Faber with him, Rome Faber, the cutest little man.
And also probably the best fighter in the building. He just went through some serious health scares and was able to fight through it. Tough little guy. Let's send it up to Garrett Vertig and bring out our feature bout of the prelim card.
Now ready to make his walk, Donnie Todd.
So Donald Todd, another MMA gold fighter. He is 4-1 in his mixed martial arts campaign, coming off of two big victories. This guy has beaten the who's who, Isaac De La Torre. He just beat Jonathan Lippincott back in February of 2023 in a round one submission right here at Firepower Future Stars before we became A1 Combat. And before that, he beat Eric Duong in a knockout. And he, by the way, submission round number one against Lippincott back in February.
Yeah, you know, 100% finish rate coming into this fight, that's very impressive. You know, especially from somebody that's not what we'd call padding his record. You know, he seems to have been very well matched throughout his amateur career, and he's managed to pull off 100% finish rate, so it'd be exciting to see if he can continue that trend tonight. You know, his last fight was at featherweight in February, so, you know, only a few months ago. It'd be exciting to see, like, say, moving into this fight. He's fighting another, you know, undefeated guy. So it'd be exciting to see if he can get the finish here tonight.
And in his corner was Diego Bigelow, another fighter on the roster here at A1 Combat. By the way, guys, Donald Todd, number 3 in Nevada ranked amateur featherweights, number 18 in California, and number 26 on the West Coast. So Donald Todd is a great fighter.
Yeah, and as you say, we've already had some MMA gold guys out here tonight. They've been doing very well. They train at a very high level. Plenty of UFC guys to train with. So great experience to pull from coming into these amateur fights. And as you say, he's very experienced at the amateur so far. And I'm sure soon he'll be looking to advance into the pro ranks, especially with such a high finish rate. It just goes as a testament to his skills currently for the amateur division.
Absolutely, let's send it up to Garrett to bring out his opponent.
And now please welcome Mason Hartshorn.
And Mason Hartshorn, he's 3-0, you know, his last two fights were in February, so he fought twice within a month. You know, those were at featherweight. He has one knockout in round one, so also clearly got the finishing capabilities. So I think this fight's going to be a very exciting fight, very high pace. But like I say, both guys have shown themselves to be finishers, and I'm really excited to see what they put on display here tonight.
Yeah, absolutely. And this guy has been super active. Like you said, his last two fights came in the same month, and they were just 14 days apart. Both of those were victories. He's yet to lose. But prior to that, his first fight was in December of 2022. So he's had all these fights in about 7 months to get his record up to 3-0 here tonight. as he takes on Donnie Todd.
Yeah, and I love to see that from these guys. You know, they're staying active, they're gaining the experience, and, you know, I'm not saying everyone has to rush through things. Like, obviously, everyone takes a different path, but the most experience you can get at this level, the better, as he gets slapped by his coach, getting pumped up, clearly.
Damn Black.
You know, I think it's great for him to have such experience, because at the end of the day, then you completely negate all the jitters. You know, it becomes like second nature to you. You're used to being in this cage, in front of the lights, the crowd, and everything, as we've talked about. And I think it's great to get as much experience at the amateur level as possible. And people are getting a lot more experience these days, and there are a lot of amateurs that are training as professionals. I feel like the sport as a whole is being taken a lot more serious. And I think that it's great to see these guys really capitalizing on the opportunities that are presented to them.
Absolutely, in A1 Combat, one of the best opportunities out there for young fighters. Between these two, they are 7-1. So this is a great fight to have as our feature bout on the prelim. Coming up next, Blaze Proper, Laquan Jenkins in the main event. On the prelims will be Nico Kalunga taking on Andrew Toasty Tosti for the A1 Combat Amateur title. That'll be good. And by the way, Andrew Tosti comes out to Stone Cold Steve Austin's music, so he's a big wrestling fan. Let's send it up to... Let's check out the tail of the tape first. 32 years old for Donald Todd. 8 years the younger is Mason Hartshorn. Donald Todd 5-1, although I have him at 4-1. There's a discrepancy there. 135.8 pounds. He is 5'7" tall. 3 inches shorter, 5'4", for Mason Hartshorn, 134 pounds. He is 3-0 undefeated in his mixed martial arts campaign. Garrett Fertig, let's get it started.
A1 Combat heads back to the Bantamweight division, presented by FitPros.com. Their mission is to empower brands of all size to achieve their full potential through the art of print. Find them online at FitPrintBros.com. We now go three-minute rounds, introducing first the Legacy Farms Blue Corner. At 5'7" tall, he weighed in 135.8 pounds with 5 wins and 1 loss, including a first-round submission victory in his last fight. He represents MMA Gold and fights out of Sacramento, California, Donnie Todd. And now introducing his opponent across the cage, fighting out of the Legacy Farms red corner. Standing 5'4" tall, weighing 134 pounds, entering tonight perfect as an amateur with 3 wins, no defeats. He represents Team Black and fights out of Antioch, California, Mason Hartshorn. Your referee, David Shirley.
Well, if Garrett Fertig says it's Hartshorn, then it's Hartshorn. So I've been saying it wrong for the last few days. So Mason Hartshorn is in the black trunks with the red trim, and the red Muay Thai trunks belong to his opponent, Donnie Todd. I'm sorry, I've got that backwards. Mason Hartshorn in the Muay Thai trunks, Donald Todd in the black trunks with the red trim. Don't want to confuse you guys. Here we go. David Shirley says, let's rock. And this will be 3 minutes. And you notice no shin guards on these two guys as we see that outside leg kick come in from Hartshorn, as Garrett Fertig has now schooled me on how to say that name properly. And I appreciate that.
So curious about Mason Hartshorn. That tattoo on his ribs, I believe, is the wrestling logo that they all get tattooed on them. And then he has walked out in Muay Thai shorts. So
yes.
And he is looking to wrestle here tonight. So I wonder if that was a little bit of a trick on his behalf, try to lure him into a false sense of security in the striking aspects. But he's doing a great job here of controlling the head position. He has the underhook against the cage, and he's really giving Todd a hard time getting out here. Todd needs to let go of that wizard.
Mason Hartshorn, definitely a Division I wrestler and one of the best. And Jeremy Lukow from Iridium Sports Agency, and of course 559 Fights, who we work very closely with here at A1 Combat, was very big on Mason Hartshorn when I messaged him. And that was a uppercut that went awry and low on Donnie Todd. And actually, couldn't have come at any better time for Donald Todd, because he was in a little bit of trouble right there. But Donald Todd obviously can get himself out of trouble, and nobody wants to get hit low. So he's a little upset about that. David Shirley will check on him. He'll have, I think, 5 minutes to recover here if he needs it. Mason Hartshorn was feeling himself, and he didn't really want that break in the action. But got to keep those punches up, and David Shirley will reprimand him now.
Yeah, I've got I don't have to worry about that so much. But, no, unfortunate here. Like you say, Hartshorn was having a lot of success there. But, you know, he looks calm, he looks composed, and I'm sure he's going to, you know, just get straight back at it.
And speaking of that, here we go. They touch gloves. No harm done, no foul.
Oh, nice leg kick there.
Although it was a foul. Left hand from Hartshorn, another left hand from Todd. Inside leg kicks coming in hot and heavy from Hartshorn, who just eats a shot. Now, I think he got hit low.
He did.
And you got to wonder if it's a little MLB action here. You hit the batter, so we hit your batter.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. I mean, like I say, accidents happen in there. Both guys were throwing those inside leg kicks, which I've firsthand learned, obviously training with a lot of men myself. Those inside leg kicks, they can sneak up there sometimes. So, you know, it is unfortunate, but a total accident, and I'm sure Hartson was going to take his time, and he's going to recover, and then we'll be
Corey,
we'll
you
be
don't know that
in.
Was an accident. Donald Todd might have been getting some revenge. No, I'm just kidding. Donald Todd comes from MMA Gold. He would never do that on purpose. And David's laughing. He said, I know you didn't do it on purpose, but it looks bad. So just try to keep it up after it just happened. Uriah Faber's in the booth with us, but he won't put the headset on until the pro. He looks really good. Look at Uriah tonight, looking clean cut, pretty. I like it. Oh, and it already starts. He's not even on the headset yet. I'm already being insulted by the California kid. Ooh. Big shots from Hartshorn.
I like the pressure from Hartshorn here. He's using those jabs to back him up. He's throwing those leg kicks. Oh, a beautiful roll there into the clinch. And he knocked his head back with that uppercut. He's had a lot of success with the striking. Honestly, I don't think he needs to grapple, but I do enjoy watching somebody mix up their skill set and just show a very well-rounded game within the sport. You know, like, it's
absolutely
no longer the day of striker versus grappler, or like, you know, I feel like the ability to go in there and show a fully well-rounded skill set at only 3-0 amateur is a huge testament to himself.
Absolutely. Donnie Todd eating shots there, and I like the way that Mason goes to the head and then the body quickly. Nice combination there. Overhand right, we call that the baseball throw at Team Salguera.
Yeah, I mean, Todd's doing a great job. He's landed a lot of strikes himself. I do feel like he needs to find a way to negate the speed of Hartshorn. He is struggling a little bit there.
Big right hand, though, as you say that. He lands a big right hand followed by a straight left on the chin of Donnie Todd. I'm of Mason Hartshorn, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not in there feeling it, so I can't speak for them, but I feel like Todd is landing the harder punches, whereas Hartshorn is, like, landing the volume and the speed.
And sometimes speed can create knockout power. It's not always the power. It's sometimes it comes from the speed of the punch.
Yeah, and also we've moved into these 3-minute rounds now, but they're still short in comparison to the pro rounds. And the amount, like the significant strikes and the volume, that knee looked like it could have gone
that
a high.
That was illegal.
That looked like it went a high.
It was after the bell as well as Jim West enters the cage. And Mason Hartshorn threw that knee to the head, and hopefully he'll get a warning there so he doesn't think that it's okay. But good fight.
Yeah, exactly. But like finishing what I was saying, I just think Todd needs to find a way to break his rhythm. And honestly, even like fakes and feints will slow him down a little bit because it'll give him something to think about. Boom. As opposed to just that one hard shot that he's landing when he comes in.
And when he did just land that shot right there, Corey, it buckled Mason just momentarily with that right hand. Donnie Todd looks like a guy who's lost a ton of weight. He's got that build where it's a guy that used to weigh a lot more and he's lost a lot of weight and got himself in shape.
Yeah, like, see, he did a beautiful job of landing that, like, straight down the middle. That was hard. That made him stop. I think he's doing a lot of great things tonight. So I'm not obviously, like, taking anything away from him. He's doing
right.
A lot of great things. But
it's
I also think this fight is his to win. If, like, say, he perhaps won't get that knockout finish with that big shot. But I think if he just finds a way to slow Hartshorn down a little bit and land more of those big shots, I honestly think he could get the finish here tonight. Like, that was a very hard overhand that he landed.
Absolutely, and this is round number two for Hartshorn and Donald Todd.
I do love the way that Hartshorn finishes those combinations with the leg kicks. He's chopping that leg, so that's also another reason he's got the speed advantage, because he is slowing down Todd by taking away his legs, which is where a lot of the speed and power comes from. So very smart on his behalf to be chopping those legs, shooting on him.
Another big heavy right hand though from Don Todd.
Yeah, talking about those leg kicks, but he is leaving his head on the center when he throws them, which is allowing Todd to hit down the middle. I think if Todd
right there.
Yeah. Like, he did better there. I think if he threw like 2-3 more hard shots, he would start taking advantage.
Corey McKenna, he went for another knee to the head, and I don't know that he doesn't know that he's not allowed to do that.
Yeah, I mean, if it lands, it's one thing. Obviously, a lot of people do throw them to the chest, which I don't advise for amateurs because it's risky anyway if the person dips for a takedown or something. But I'm sure our referees are taking a close look, and if anything does slip or go wrong, they will for sure be giving him a talking to.
Right. 2 minutes left in round number two. Of course, these are 3-minute rounds.
Hartshorn does look a lot smaller. I mean, in these exchanges, but he is not having any issues with controlling Todd in these positions, which just, again, like, is a huge testament to his skill in terms of technique as opposed to physicality.
Absolutely.
Great job from Todd here to swim that underhook and reverse the position. These guys are both doing amazing things tonight, like way above their experience. As you say, like from the amateur fights, I feel like the level has just increased drastically over the last couple of years. Like both guys are fighting like professionals, or you know. Look, great job swimming that underhook, looking to get off. Neither guy is settling on a position. They're each staying active. Beautiful body shot there from Hearthstone. I really like the way he's changing up these levels. Like you say, he's mixing in his kicks with his hands. He's mixing his wrestling with his striking. But again, like Todd's doing a great job of breaking, circling. I'm really impressed with both of these guys tonight. I think this is a great matchup.
And I can't tell, but it looks like Max Payne Griffin sitting cage side over there. From my vantage point, I could be wrong. But right now, Hartshorn has Donald Todd up against the cage. And this is a great fight. Round number two, winding down, just 36 seconds left to go. Jim Cooley, the voice of champions. Corey Poppins McKenna, UFC strawweight, Team Alpha Male.
Yeah, exactly. I've got to say that Hearthstone is stealing this round again. Obviously won the first, quite clearly, I think. So I think Todd needs to find a way to mix things up a little bit. Like I say, he's having success with those heavy rear hands. And I think he just needs to maybe not rush in so hard, use a little bit of footwork to stop Hearthstone from being able to close that gap and get these takedowns.
As I say it, he does it.
But I mean, like I say, both guys are showing a great skill set.
Hartshorn's in his corner, so he didn't have to move, but he did look a little tired there at the end of the second stanza. He looked like he may be getting a little tired. Donnie Todd does not look to be any more tired than he was in round one. That could play a part here in round number three.
Yeah, I mean, if you're not tired in a fight, you're not putting out enough work. You know, like this is a very high output for him. He's using his speed. He's using his, like,
right.
You know, his wrestling. He's
Ooh, that was an elbow, and nobody caught it, but he threw a right hand, and there's another one. He's slipping some elbows. I don't think they're on purpose, Corey McKenna, but Donnie Todd has landed a couple elbows.
Yeah, and that's the problem with, like, even if it was deliberate, like, a lot of these amateurs, like I say, they train like pros, so it is sometimes hard to take away those
Correct. Skills.
Like, say, if he's training at a Muay Thai gym, I can guarantee you they're throwing knees to the head and they're throwing elbows.
Absolutely.
Because at the end of the day, no one's preparing you to be an amateur. They're preparing you to be a professional. They're preparing you to be a world champion. So sometimes I do feel like guys sometimes struggle to take those tools out of their toolbox.
Right.
But I don't think those look deliberate to me. But I'll always err on the side of believing the best in someone.
Correct. Blood trickling out of the nose of Mason Hartshorn.
Yeah, he's taken some damage tonight. You know, he's eaten some heavy strikes.
Big right hand there. Yeah. And I'll tell you what, he trains with Team Black, which is a striking team. I mean, they do everything over there, but they're a kickboxing team as well, Muay Thai. And so he can eat shots. I'm sure he's sparring stand-up quite often.
Yeah, ooh, he nearly ducked into that knee there. That would have been a total accident, of course. Todd was throwing a kick. He needs to be careful.
Ooh, and it's a big takedown.
Big slam.
He's going to immediately go for his back. He's got one hook in, two hooks in. He's flattening him out. He's got 2 minutes and 20 seconds to work. Donnie Todd needs to figure out a way out of this, and he does.
Great job from Todd to work into a hit, but he did give that neck up.
Yeah, he did.
That is deep.
This might be
He's out of this. Perfect.
Good job by Donald Todd scrambling out of that.
And great job to not just accept a position. You know what I mean? We see too many guys, just like I say, he got flattened out. A lot of guys are like, oh, this sucks. And he didn't sit there. He worked to his hip. He started working. He's just got to be careful. He gave that wrist trap, as I was about to say it. You know, great positional awareness here from Hartshorn. You could tell that he grapples a lot. You know, he has a very great positional awareness. This choke is under the neck now. Todd is doing a good job at hand fighting and preventing him from locking this up. But again, this is a position that really wears on you.
And they have almost a full 2 minutes, and that's as long as the other fights were. So he's got plenty of time to work here. Can't see from this angle.
He's
going to stop
it.
I don't know if he's out. I think he may have tapped.
I think he tapped. Yeah. Okay, my bad.
Donald Todd taps to the grappler, the Division I wrestler, who shows that he's got some jits as well, Corey McKenna. Mason Hartshorn picks up the win here in our feature bout of the evening.
Yeah, and he stays undefeated tonight. You know, I was very impressed with his performance. Like I say, I feel like he really displayed all skill sets of mixed martial arts. And I think it's just a testament to him and his team. You know, like I say, his striking looked good. Obviously, some things to rectify in all areas, as always. Like I always say with my fights, like there's always stuff to learn from and fix. But given his experience at only 3-0, now 4-0, I think he could be very, very proud of his performance here tonight.
Absolutely. Great fight here tonight for Mason Carzino Hartshorn out of Team Black. And Team Black doing really well here tonight. Let's take a look at the replays here as Dominic Hidalgo also picked up a win here tonight. There's that double leg as he changed levels, takes him down quickly. Todd tries to get back up, but Hartshorn very strong on the ground, as you alluded to, Corey McKenna. He grapples a lot.
Yeah, exactly. He did a great job of staying composed, you know. Like, he took some damage, and he definitely had a couple moments where he was a little, you know, a little wobbled, but he did a good job of not panicking, not getting overzealous and too aggressive, and leaving himself open to get further, like, further damage. And, you know, I think it really paid off in there. Like, he stayed calm, wait till the third round, the opportunity presented itself, and, yeah, I think he could be very, very happy with his performance coming out here tonight.
Absolutely. Picks up another win here for Team Black. Garrett Fertig is in the cage. They're taking the gloves off of Donnie Todd, and we will get them both to the center of the cage. And David Shirley will raise the hand of our winner, Mason Hartshorn. Let's send it up to the voice of A1 Combat.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee David Shirley waves off the contest. 1 minute, 28 seconds of round at number 3. Declaring your winner by TKO, Mason Hartshorn.
Hartshorn moves to 4-0. Technical knockout victory here tonight. It says, I don't get that. I think it was a submission. I don't think it was a TKO. I think we had a sub there. Rear naked choke followed by a tap out as Jim West shakes the
co-main event, Laquan Jenkins.
Okay, walking out now, we have Laquan Jenkins. He is 4-0. I mean, on Tapology, he's 7-1, as we discussed earlier. Sometimes the camo records are a little different to everything we see displayed. He has a 50% finish rate coming into this fight. You know, like I say, he had his 50% finish rate coming into this fight. So I'm sure he's going to look to get more finishes. He's going to be looking to put, you know, a dominant performance on display tonight. And I did also note that he has fought predominantly at flyweight, so moving up a weight class tonight.
And let me tell you something cool about Laquan Jenkins. We talked a little bit earlier about Christian Alba. Laquan Jenkins lives in Las Vegas. Now, A1 Combat, we were keeping it local for the Emmys. Of course, we fly in pros from all over the world, but we weren't going to fly anyone in. So Laquan Jenkins said, I want to fight on A1 Combat. And I said, I'm sorry, man. We're not going to fly anyone in from Vegas for the Emmy show. And he said, no, man, I'll fly myself in. He flew himself in. He flew his team in. He came out here to fight on A1 Combat to get this experience. And I'm really, really proud of this kid for everything that he worked. He had to get his California medicals while he was in Vegas. Young in his career, a great fighter is Laquan Jenkins. By the way, he is 7-1. And this kid can absolutely go. He is on a 7-fight win streak. He lost his very first fight in the first round, and he said, I'm never going to lose again. And guess what? He hasn't.
Yeah, and building on what you said about the paying for his own flights and everything, I will finish the statement after Garrett.
Yeah, we'll send it up to Garrett.
Please welcome his opponent, Blaze Proffer.
Okay, so before we move on to Blaze, I was just going to say that is a huge thing for an amateur. Like you say, fly out his team, fly out himself, pay for his medicals. Because Uriah always says the biggest difference between pros and amateurs, in his opinion, the only difference, especially now that everyone, like you say, is training on the same level, amateurs do not get paid.
Right.
You know, you're fighting in here for the love of fighting. Like, there's no money motivation, there's nothing. You're an amateur, you're just in here because you want to fight. And
right.
I think that's respectable. I love that.
Now, let me talk a little bit about Blaze, because he's coming off of 3 losses, but each one of those losses, first one was against Jonathan Burdick, who, by the way, was 4-0. Kieran Saunders, who was 3-0. And then he fought Nate Santos, who's one of the best amateur fighters out here in California on the West Coast, and he lost to him. But this is a guy who went the distance with 2 undefeated fighters as a young pro himself, but he rattled off 3 wins in his first 3 fights, his last loss coming back in May of this year in the first round to Nate Santos. But Blaze Proffer looking to get back on the winning side of things, and Dan Black is very high on this young prospect coming out of Team Black.
Yeah, and that's hard to do, you know, taking three losses and still sticking with it. As I said, amateur is just experience, but even still, losing hurts, like, especially when you love the sport as much as fighters love the sport. So that really says a lot about him for coming back here today, and I'm sure he's going to come out with, you know, with a fire lit under him, and he's going to be trying to rectify things that he has, fallen back on over the last few fights. You know, his fight name is the Bear Mace. I would definitely be curious as to how that came about. That is Blaise the Bear Mace Crawford.
And this is the zombie savage Laquan Jenkins. I had him in my phone as Laquan Jensen when I was matching him, and now it's stuck in my head. But it's the zombie savage and the Bear Mace. And there you see Blaise. And again, both of his teammates that fought here tonight have won. So he's going to have to come out there and show out, Corey McKenna.
Yeah, exactly. And the great thing about having so many teammates on a fight card is you're going through the trenches together, your training camps together, your dieting kit together, your cutting together. And I really think that support system brings a lot into a fight, too. It's probably a lot to do with their successes.
And we check out the tail of the tape. 30 years old for Laquan Jenkins, 7-1, amazing record, 135.5, 5'10". Both guys 5'10", 135 pounds for Blaise Proffer. He is 3-3 and 6 years younger than Laquan Jenkins. Garrett Fertig, let's go.
Our next bout is brought to you by Dryco, your one-stop company for asphalt, concrete, and fencing services. Schedule your free estimate at dryco.com. We're now ready to go three-minute rounds in the bantamweight division. Introducing first, the Legacy Farms Blue Corner. At 5 feet, 10 inches tall, weigh 135.6 pounds. Currently riding a 7-fight win streak. His record stands at 7 wins, just 1 loss, 3 by submission, 2 by knockout. Representing Salt Kings Jiu-Jitsu, he fights out of Las Vegas, Nevada, Laquan Savage Zombie Jenkins. And now introducing his opponent across the cage, fighting out of the Legacy Farms Red Corner. At 5 feet 10 inches tall, weighing 135 pounds, with a record of 3 wins, 3 losses, he represents Team Dum Dum Maya and Team Black, and fights out of Antioch, California, Bear Mace, Blaise Proffer. Your referee, David Shirley.
So Dan Lewis, a heavyweight out of this area, he's since moved, but he's a great fighter that fought out here for a long time, texted me a moment ago and said Laquan Jenkins can fight. So we're about to find out. And at 7-1, I got to believe he can. Blaise Proffer going to try to stop the juggernaut that is on a 7-fight win streak. The Savage Zombie, they touch gloves. White trunks belong to Laquan.
These are some tall bantamweights. I feel like they all keep growing in these weight divisions.
Big right hand from Laquan. He's very calm. I like his boxing stance. Dan Lewis told me he could fight, so let's see if Dan knows. And yes, he can.
He
big right hand. Changes levels. Blaise doing a good job here, trying to stay on his feet. Laquan looking for the takedown, although I think he was doing very well with his hands. I might create some separation here and throw some more shots. Got him stumbled there for a second, Corey McKenna.
Yeah, I mean, he definitely stung him. Blaise did a great job of pummeling that underhook and kind of stuffing that takedown that Jenkins shot on him. He landed a big overhand of his own, but yeah, he definitely got caught in that first exchange. Definitely doesn't look out of it now, though, and seems quite calm and composed as he looks to get off this cage.
A little behind-the-scenes narrative here. Laquan Jenkins was not training for this fight. He told me that he's not really there with his cardio like he normally would. He got hit low there. And he wanted to go two-minute rounds, but Blaise said, let's go three, and Laquan said, you know what, let's do it. So three-minute rounds here, no shin guards. Laquan Jenkins, I would like to see him spin this around and create some separation and throw some more leather. He did say he got hit low. David Shirley did not see it. David Shirley, of course, one of the most well-versed referees in camo and CSAC.
Yeah, great head positioning here from Proffer. Like, he seems to be very comfortable controlling that position. Great job getting the underhook from Jenkins here. Both guys are doing a great job of controlling this position against the cage. Beautiful. You know, Proffer went for the toss there. It didn't pay off. You know, he fell to a knee, he got stuck, and he got reversed. Great job for Jenkins to jump on that and capitalize. He just needs to be careful. His hips were a little high. He didn't get reversed, luckily.
Well, what he did was he used the cage to push off and get in that side control, but Blaise did a good job getting back in the guard there.
Yeah, exactly.
He had one butterfly in and one close guard.
And I love the Proffer here. He has not locked his guard. As I say, with MMA, like, you – like lying on your back with your your legs crossed or holding on to them, you're not going to improve your position. Yes, if you're a submission specialist and you can throw up submissions, it's great. But I just you don't want to be taking damage there. So it's a great job from him for playing that like more open guard style. Like he had his foot on his hip to create space. Now he's in half guard. He got a head now. That's tight.
Very tight. He's got 28 seconds to work if he can finish this right now.
He's kind of got
Laquan looking for a first round finish, but I think it looks like Blaise is okay. He seems to be okay here.
Yeah, I think he did a great job of controlling that that far side arm to prevent him from getting that DAS fully through. And a great job to get on top here. Perfect. Swung that arm out, controlled the hips. Great job from both guys here to stay positionally aware. And they're also very calm and composed in there. Like you say, they've both got a great deal of experience in there. You know, 8 fights for Jenkins, 6 fights for Profer. So both guys are very comfortable being in that cage and performing, you know, under, like say, in front of this whole environment. It can be very daunting for people, but they're very, very composed in there tonight. Like you say, that's just a testament to their experience.
Absolutely. Let's take a look at some of the replays here of that first round. There you see Laquan has him up against the cage. This is where I believe he looks for the takedown knee. They trade knees there, and he tries to take him down, as you said, but Laquan does a great job getting on top. And worked from there for the rest of the round. Laquan Jenkins probably stole round number one. In fact, I know he did. And there he looked for that Darce choke, or looked like a Darce.
Yeah, it looks a little bit modified. Honestly, I don't want to call what that is.
Yeah, it's a little different.
He kind of shot the head and arm in guillotine a little bit, then locked it up kind of like Anaconda Darce style. I liked it. Just luckily, Profer did a great job of fighting that hand.
Absolutely. Profer in the black trunks, Laquan Jenkins in the white trunks, co-main event of our prelims here tonight. He wants to touch gloves, and Profer said, okay, round number two. And we're going to get this one started. We are running low on time, guys. We're going to head over to UFC Fight Pass promptly at 8 p.m. for our pro portion of the card, including our main event, Coin versus Juarez for the featherweight title.
He needs Laquan to be careful. That's twice now that he's had that kick caught. Sorry.
No, you're right, and Laquan hasn't done much with it yet except get him up against the cage, but it only takes once, Corey McKenna, for that to really cause some problems.
Yeah, exactly, and I don't know if you noticed, but Profer was breathing pretty heavy in his corner, and people kind of don't seem to realize how heavily like this wrestling cardio wears on you. Having another person's body weight on top of you, that's tiring.
Laquan Jenkins trying to work from the top. I would love to see Laquan let him stand up here and throw some more hands. But Laquan wants to grapple.
Yeah, I mean, he's having success here, so I don't see why he wouldn't. Profer is, like, he's doing a good job of trying to create space, kick him away and get up, but
right.
I feel like he's getting that space and he's not being proactive enough to actually get up. You know, he kicked him away and then he allowed him to come back in, and it's easier said than done.
It looked like he thought he was closer to the cage. Corey tried to do a quick wall walk, and when he reached back, it wasn't there, and he sort of fell backwards, so a little bit, he thought he was closer to the cage, I think, there when he tried to get up after that kick.
Yeah, and it's also very daunting having someone stood over you trying to,
throwing punches
and kicks at you. So it is definitely easier said than done. Obviously, we're sat here watching it on a TV screen, so it's way easier to tell them what they should be doing. But when you're in there, it feels completely different. I love this knee shield from him here to create space. He's kind of playing with that arm to threaten. He's got a good stiff arm here to start creating space and start backing up to do a technical stand-up. As he does it, beautiful work there from Profer to get up. He needs to stop. Like when he gets up, he's pausing. It's allowing Jenkins to reshoot, which is why he's in this position.
He was looking for something there, was Blaise, and not really. Really, it's more of just to try to stop the onslaught of Laquan Jenkins, the savage zombie, who is on top currently of Bear Mace. And there you see Sauce Marley in the corner of Bear Mace. Blaise.
Yeah, he jumped on like kind of like an arm and guillotine. Honestly, I'm not a huge arm and guillotine fan personally. Ooh.
Yeah, it's very hard to finish that, actually. It's very rare that you see that finish. That is Max Payne Griffin right there with the red hat backwards. Sitting cage side here, UFC's.
Great job from Profer here, splitting the legs, keeping the hips elevated of Jenkins with that body lock. And I think he just, I thought he was going to sit back on that. I think here he just needs to kind of recover himself, compose himself. You know, we've got 20 seconds left. I think he's down 2 rounds. So definitely need to see what his corner team bring to the table for him to switch things up moving into the fourth, the third, sorry. I was about to say, you know, he's looking at his fourth loss if he keeps allowing Jenkins to control the fight in the way that he is. But a huge testament to him, you know, he's not fighting scrubs. Like you say, looking down his record, he's fought guys with, like, as good as, better records than him. Like, you know, Jenkins, he's got double the wins that he does. So he's definitely not trying to pad himself or sandbag, and I think this is a great experience for him. Overall, he's doing a lot of things very well. Our beautiful, lovely, sweetheart ring girl, Kayla, in the cage right now.
That's your friend. That's why you're saying that. You're biased, but Kayla is awesome. I will say this, as we look back at some of the replays here, Laquan, that was the one and only time that he was on his back during this fight. We move to round number three. We have 20 minutes before we move over to UFC Fight Pass, guys. We still have a title fight here to go on prelims, so stick around here. But make sure if you have not signed up for UFC Fight Pass, as Corey Poppins McKenna said, you can get a free trial if you make your way over to UFC Fight Pass. Uriah Faber's A1 Combat is in Sacramento, the 916 at the Hard Rock Casino Resort. Jim Cooley, the voice of champions. And Corey Poppins McKenna, UFC strawweight, holder of many records in the UFC. David Shirley's in the center of the cage. Third and final round. Here we go. Co-main event of our preliminary card. They touch gloves for the last time. Blaise with a half-hearted left hand there.
Definitely some hesitancy going into this third round, or maybe even fatigue. I mean, like I said before, it's very wearing to have somebody on you. I know you fought yourself in the past.
Right.
I'm sure. Have you felt that? Or
yes,
you
yes, absolutely. Especially
kind of
if it's a really good wrestler, because everything that you think you can do to get out from underneath him doesn't work, and it really tires you out. You know what I mean? They're so good at controlling that body from the top.
Yeah, I love it when I read the comments on the UFC, and they're all like, "I wouldn't let a man do that to me." It's like, if someone knows what they're doing,
they
do it to you whether you like it or not.
So Laquan Jenkins went for a spinning elbow, which would have been illegal, by the way. And then he tried to fall down or roll down into a knee bar and wasn't able to reach that leg. And now on top is Blaise Proffer.
Do we want to err on the side of caution and hope he was throwing a spinning back fist?
We do, because it was a bad angle. And you know what? He may have been throwing a back fist.
Great job here from Proffer, though. I love the knee staple. I actually like this more than taking a full mount. It controls the hips a little bit more. He's doing a good job of staying composed here. Though I do think we need a little bit of urgency, and he would benefit from, you know, just controlling Jenkins for a little bit and then posturing up and just throwing as many strikes as he can to finish this fight. You know, he's got a minute 30, probably down two rounds. What do you think, Jim?
Absolutely, he's down two rounds. And I'll tell you what, he's on top here, but he's not going to win this fight if he wins this round. Because like we said, he's down two rounds. He needs a finish. And just laying here, throwing shots to the body of Laquan Jenkins is not going to get him a finish. Laquan is looking to wall walk here and try to get back to his feet. And that might be good for Blaise coming out of that Muay Thai camp of Dan Black, and maybe he can land a big shot and end this fight, because that is what he's going to need to do here, Corey.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I feel like his moment to do it was when he had Jenkins' hips further from the cage and his head was against the cage, because there it's very hard to wall walk. But now he's got his hips back to the cage, so he's not able to really put his full power into those punches, because he still has to use his hips and his weight to control Jenkins.
Absolutely. And he's on top of Laquan, but like I said, 40 seconds left. Too little, too late. Listen, Uriah and I have decided that we're not going to pick any winners anymore, because sometimes we're wrong. I feel like Laquan Jenkins has won this fight. Blaise Proffer is doing a very good job in round number three. He's a great fighter out of a great camp. Should a few of the judges have given him round one or two against our judgment, he could end up winning this fight. So I don't want to say for sure, but I think Laquan Jenkins is up 20-18 at this point, and I think this fight is going to end. I'm sorry. He is up, 20-18, and this fight is going to end 29-28, most likely, for Laquan Jenkins. My math got a little crazy. Right? Hector Fajardo sat down. He's so sexy, I couldn't pay attention to anything else.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you. You know, that was a great third round for Proffer, but I just don't think it's enough for him to steal that fight. Unfortunately, like you said, we never really know we do know what the judges are looking at. You know, I studied the judging criteria meticulously. I lost a couple of decisions that I didn't agree with. Like, I've had two losses in my career, and I didn't agree with either of them. So I've become a little bit of a stickler for the judging criteria. But, like, say, everyone's looking for different things. Sometimes you have predominantly boxing judges. You have,
right,
like, people that, like, train themselves in grappling, so they like that more. And, like, judging is an opinion at the end of the day. You have guidelines, but judging is an opinion. But in my opinion, Jenkins is up two rounds, and he's going to take that win here tonight.
Absolutely, and I know Garrett is hustling over there to get the decision, and that's all really all on Camo. They have to give it to him when they can. But we are going to try to get you guys this decision quickly. What we do not want to do is not be able to have our main event here on the prelims, but we do have a time schedule. Right now it's looking like we are going to be okay. We've got about 14 minutes as it stands before we go live on UFC Fight Pass with our opening pro fight of the evening, and that'll be Joseph Keith and Czar Charles in a welterweight battle, but you got to go over to UFC Fight Pass for that. Here comes Garrett Fertig. Let's get this party started.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of action-packed action, we go to your three judges at cage side for the decision. All three judges, Brian Tyler, Randy Silva, and Wayne Phillips, see that it's the same. 29-28 for your winner by unanimous decision, Laquan Savage Zombie Jenkins.
So Laquan Jenkins flies himself out from Las Vegas, steps on the big stage in the co-main event of the evening on the preliminaries, and picks up a victory. The crowd may not like it, but Laquan Jenkins doesn't care. He moves to 8-1 in his mixed martial arts campaign. He'll head back to Las Vegas, Nevada with that win. And Dan Black congratulates him. We've got to get everybody out of the cage and move on to our main event of the evening.
Yeah, I definitely think that you can't dispute that win. Like I say, the crowd can boo all they like, but I think that was a pretty clear two-round advantage for Jenkins. Okay, as we shoo them out of the cage, we are ready to give you your main prelim of the night. That will be Andrew Tosti versus Nicholas
Kalunga.
I want to make sure that I don't mess up those names, but this is your first ever A1 amateur title. And I am very excited for these guys to make history here tonight, Jim.
Absolutely. And this should be a great one. Bantamweight title on the line. Tosti Tosti and Nico Kalunga. All right, here we go. Garrett Fertig is going to bring him out right now.
Please welcome the first fight for our featured prelim, Nico Kalunga.
Okay, and Kalunga is, Kalunga is walking out right now. He is undefeated. He's coming off a round one knockout, and he's representing Academy of Combat Arts from South Dakota. I correct myself. I looked at Tapology. That would be Oakdale MMA was what I was given. Anyway, regardless, he is undefeated, coming off a first round knockout, so I'm sure he's gonna be riding that hype tonight, and he's gonna be looking to, you know, kick things off the way he left them, and I'm very excited to see what he brings in here tonight.
Me as well. And Nico Kalunga comes out of Professor Tom Theofanopoulos' Last Stand Fight Team. You see Justin Smitley in the corner. You see Lamar Reed. He is a title contender here in A1 combat as well. You see Uriah Faber behind him giving the claps. And that is Carol the Cup Woman. She needs to hurry through this. We got to get this fight started, guys. We're going to do a rolling intro into UFC Fight Pass. We're not going to have a stand-up here tonight. It'll just move to me and Uriah Faber. After this amateur title fight, we will roll right in to UFC Fight Pass for the pro portion of this card.
And now his opponent, Andrew Tosti.
Okay, Andrew Tosti, 5-5 out of Antox MMA. He has a 60% finish rate. He's like probably gonna look to continue that tonight, look to get that finish. But as I say, Kalunga is coming off that first round knockout. So both guys with finishing capabilities in here tonight. And I'm very excited for this matchup. I don't think we could have asked for a better matchup for the first ever A1 amateur title.
Absolutely, and I'll tell you something. When I got the call from Tom Anderson to make this amateur card, the first guy I wanted on this show was Andrew Tosti Tosti. I'd seen him fight for the title down in Santa Cruz, so I called Angel Figueroa, and I said, hey, man, I want Tosti on this card, and he said, let's make it happen. His first opponent fell out. He got injured over at MMA Gold, so we moved to Nico Kalunga, who is 4-0, coming out of Tosti Evanopoulos' camp, but I really like Toasty Tosti. He's a good guy. He's a great fighter. You can hear him coming out to the Stone Cold Steve Austin music. This is for the A1 title, and this is going to be a good fight. We've got plenty of time now, guys, because we're going to roll into UFC Fight Pass as we get a chance to do that. So make sure you guys head over to UFC Fight Pass. But finish this fight first. You'll have a little bit of time to go over there. If you haven't signed up, start signing up now.
Yeah, this is a great matchup, as I say. Jim did a great job here. I'm very excited. Personally, I don't think this one's going to go the distance. Both guys are very exciting coming into this fight, and both guys look very calm and collected. Like I say, very experienced individuals, and great for the first title. We're going to send it over to Garrett to announce the fight.
No, actually, we're going to check out the tail of the tape. 26 years old for Nico Kalunga, 30 for Tosti, 3-0 to 5-5 for Tosti, 135.5, 135.8 for Tosti. Both guys 5'10", bantamweight title on the line. Garrett Fertig, let's go.
Anyone caught out would like to once again remind everyone logging on to UFC Fight Pass at 8 p.m. to continue watching our 7-fight main card featuring the co-main and main event for the A1 Combat Strongweight and Featherweight Championships. A1 now concludes our prelims this evening with three-minute rounds for the A1 Combat Amateur Bantamweight Championship. This amateur title is sanctioned by the California Amateur Mixed Martial Arts Organization. Introducing first, the Legacy Farms Blue Corner. Standing 5 feet 10 inches tall, weighing 135.6 pounds, undefeated as an amateur at 3-0, including a first round knockout victory. He represents Oakdale MMA and fights out of Modesto, California, Nico Kalunga. And now introducing his opponent across the cage, fighting out of the Legacy Farms red corner. Standing 5 feet 10 inches tall, weighing 135.8 pounds. With 5 wins and 5 losses, he represents Ant Dog MMA and fights out of Gilroy, California, Andrew Toasty Tosti. Your referee for our amateur main event, David Shirley.
Okay, so this is a 3x3 minute fight. You know, this is still at the amateurs, as we say, it may be for a title, but with the amateurs, don't often see championship rounds because, I mean, we just don't often see it. So three-minute rounds for these guys based on their amateur experience. And off the bat, we have Tosti landing a hard hook. He's pressuring for, oh, beautiful combination from Kalunga, though.
Maroon trunks with the black trim for Kalunga, red trunks for Toasty Tosti, who, by the way, has held a couple of titles in the amateur ranks here in California. Lands a big combination there.
Kalunga needs to be careful. He is getting hit with that left hook of Tosti. Both of them are switching their stances, which I like, but they're... Whoa.
And they're exchanging big shots. Rock'em Sock'em Robots in the main event of our prelims for the the bantamweight title here at A1 Amateur. And Tosti on the ground, side control now for Nico Kalunga.
Wonderful job from Kalunga to duck under and take that takedown. You know, he got his leg chopped. He was off balance. You know, so it was a great job on him to switch the direction of the fight and take it to the ground. I feel like both guys were having success landing hard punches on the feet. But I definitely think it would have been an early night for one of them if they stayed there.
Absolutely, and right now back on his feet is Andrew Toasty Tosti. He'll try to take
beautiful
him down again.
Beautiful lat toss.
Yeah, Kalunga has some great grappling off of his feet.
Yeah, I really love that toss. That was perfectly timed. He did a great job here. He's staying very calm. He's controlling those hips. And a great display of experience here from both guys. I mean, Toasty definitely has the aggression, and he's landing a lot more, a lot harder strikes on the
correct
feet. But I really love how smoothly Kalunga is changing through these
by
positions.
The way, guys, this fight was matched at 145. This is for the featherweight title. The bantamweight on the screen and on their card is actually incorrect. These guys are 145. Tosti and Kalunga fighting for the featherweight championship here. The first ever A1 Combat amateur title that we've ever given out. Tosti landing big shots from the top.
I think we're looking at another fight where Kalunga has the speed. He's got the scrambles.
Looking for Kimura.
He's got that Kimura locked up. And then Tosti we're looking at like the hard punches and the kind of the strengthening out of position.
He's like the grinded out fighter.
Yeah, and neither is wrong. I really enjoyed the scrambles of Kalunga, and I'd be interested to see how he's going to get out of this position because I do feel like Tosti's doing more damage in the positions he has.
Full mount for Tosti, but Tosti is also trying to avoid that Kimura lock, which Kalunga can use to get out of that full mount, which is exactly what he did.
Great Kimura roll there. Unfortunately, the cage is in the way, but it initiates a scramble and allows him to advance his position. He's not mounted, taking damage. So a great, like, great fight IQ there from Kalunga to just initiate a scramble, which sometimes is the only way. It doesn't guarantee you're going to get up or be in a better position, but it definitely, you know, delays the damage, which he is now taking from top here from Tosti.
And Tosti landing big shots, and David Shirley steps in. I don't know if that was the end of the round. No, it's the end of the round.
Stayed
he didn't stop the fight. In the corner of Nico Kalunga is Justin Smitley, brother of Michael Mayday McDonald, who fought the founder of the Feast here, Uriah Faber, back at Power Balance Pavilion in the UFC. And that was a great fight as well. And we're going to check out the replays here. Tosti and Kalunga. Kalunga lands a big right there, swings, and then Tosti lands two of his own. 135. All right, guys, so real quick, there's been some discrepancies. This match was matched at 145. They came in at 135. We are having the 135 title here tonight, so it is the bantamweight title. I'm the guy who match made this card. I'm also the lead commentator. I should probably know these things. Unfortunately, I guess I do not. So, but this is for the 135 title, bantamweight title here tonight.
Yeah, I mean, that was a very close round. I'd be curious to see how the judges scored that. Like I say, I feel like Tosti landed harder strikes, but Kalunga had some great scrambles in there and had more control time. So a very close first round and a very evenly matched fight. Like I say, both guys with a different style, but both guys having successes in their own regard. Oh, beautiful. I love how Kalunga's playing with the range. He's pulling slightly and throwing his counters, but he is still getting controlled in terms of cage control from Tosti. You know, he's getting walked down. Oh, he jumped that guillotine, though. That's risky, but I think he's deep.
It looks like Tosti is going to get out of this.
Jumping a guillotine is risky, especially with MMA, when you guys are, like, especially with the guys, because they're sweaty and everything. Like, I fight in a rash guard, so there's a little bit more grip, but...
I'm sorry, did you say they're sweaty?
Sweaty.
Sweaty.
Great job from Tosti to end up on top here. That was very good, like, composure to not freak out with the guillotine. And now he's just controlling that top position, and he's going to be looking to land more damage. And I feel like Kalunga was kind of saved by the bell a little bit in the last round.
Yes.
So now he has 2 whole minutes to work in this position, and, I mean, it begs the question, is he going to get that finish now?
Absolutely. And I'll tell you what, though, Kalunga was doing a good job in that first round. Even though he was saved by the bell at the end, at least in my opinion and yours, he was doing really well up to that point before Tosti was able to get on top. And he's going to wishbone him here.
I love the scrambles here from Kalunga. He's doing a great job of keeping the momentum moving, so he's not settling and taking damage. You know, he's coming up out the back door with that underhook. Great job reversing that position. And he is across the body here, so technically he could be looking to set up that Von Flue. He didn't. He stuck with his head out.
What do you know about the Von Flue choke, Corey McKenna?
Kind of invented it.
My buddy Jason Von Flue might I don't know what the word I'm looking for is, but he's not happy that you said that. Let's put it that
it's
way.
Okay. Fun
sound
fact,
like George
he
Bush
actually,
right there.
I think he messaged me after that fight. It was kind of cool.
Great
guy. I did fangirl a little bit, I won't lie.
I was scheduled to fight Jason Von Flue at Table Mountain back in 1999.
Oh, arm and guillotine.
Did not happen.
We talked earlier about how hard these are to finish, but I mean... Yeah, great. At least he stayed on top.
Shout out to Jason Von Flue, by the way. And
yeah.
Corey McKenna, by the way, guys, the only female fighter in UFC history to land a Von Flue choke, correct?
Correct.
That is right. And right now, these guys are just sort of grappling. And right, Kalunga's on top for the moment, but it's been going back and forth.
I've got to say that Tosti's edging the round, even though it's
looking
been back
mission
and forth.
Control here.
He's landed more strikes. So I feel like when it's 50-50 on control, the judges are looking at who's landed the most damage or being in a position to finish the fight.
I always want him to slide it over and land that go-go plata.
Yeah, great dexterity here from Tosti. You don't really see this in the men often. Beautiful job from both guys to control this fight. But I do think that Tosti's edged this round due to the strikes that he landed on top. Kulungu's got some great scrambles, but unfortunately he's not causing as much damage.
And yes, Tossie's continuing to strike as he's transitioning.
Exactly. I don't want to call the first round. I feel like it depends on what the judges are looking at and what they've seen. Obviously, we're just looking in the moment. But from an overall picture, I think Tossie's got the upper hand currently in the fight. But I think it could very much flip the other way if Kulungu just threw more strikes when he got on top, or, you know, just caused a little bit more damage. I think that's honestly, it's the only difference in this fight is the damage that Tossie is firing and causing from these positions. And even here, he's threatening stuff. And the judges, what they're looking for is they're looking for the person that wants to finish the fight. They want finishes, or they want people to be trying to finish the fight. They don't want you to stall out or win.
Absolutely. And this is the third and final round. We will have our first ever Uriah Faber's A1 Combat Amateur Champion at the end of this fight. It will either be Tossie or Kulungu, Last Stand Fight Team, or Ant Dogs MMA. I'm already losing my voice. I still got to get on with Uriah Faber after this on UFC Fight Pass. Corey, we're going to see you in a new role here tonight. You're going to be interviewing some fighters in the cage for us on Fight Pass.
Yeah, I'm really excited, branching out a little bit, getting some more opportunities within A1. And as I was saying, A1's great for people of all walks. Like I say, I fight in the UFC, but I'm out here commentating, and I'm really grateful for it.
Yeah, we've got a current UFC fighter, a UFC Hall of Famer, and me, who couldn't make it to the UFC if I had a baseball bat. Here we go, guys. Final round, he's slipping a little bit, is Kulungu. Tossie landing some quick shots there.
Kulungu had a great combination just then. I believe he landed like three or four of them. Kind of stopped Tossie in his tracks. But the only problem is he's allowing Tossie to walk himself down.
Yes.
And I feel like he's actually having more success with like slipping and countering those punches, but he's just allowing himself to get walked down. Oh,
Tossie eats
overhead.
A big shot. Now, Tossie was fighting head on, but he went from southpaw to orthodox, southpaw to orthodox. Then he started fighting head on. He ate a couple shots because he wasn't offline at all, Corey McKenna.
Yeah, exactly. I feel like Kulungu would have benefited from, honestly, like keeping off of the cage and kind of trying to hold the center a little bit more, whereas Tossie was walking him down to get to this position, because he is, at the end of the day, winning these top control positions by landing the damage and the control time. Kulungu doing a good job. He's threatening that Kimura grip again. I mean, he's probably not going to, he's not going to finish the Kimura in this
position.
No,
not from that position, no.
He isn't. But it is good for him to threaten, to at least stop Tossie from getting a little bit too aggressive with those strikes. You know, it does remind him that Kulungu's there and he is threatening with stuff, and it does allow him to open up scrambles and cause movement in the fight.
Absolutely. Tossie on top, landing big shots. He's got that, or had that right arm pinned. Here comes Andrew Tossie. He wants that A1 gold, and he wants it bad.
Yeah, I think currently we're looking at...
Look at Kulungu with the reversal, but he might have got caught in a triangle. Tossie landing shots from the bottom. The crowd is going nuts.
Beautiful job. That is deep. He got the arm across. He's got everything locked up. That might be it.
Tossie looking for A1 gold, and he's going to get it. Andrew Tossie has landed a triangle choke in the first ever A1 Combat Amateur title bout here at A1 Combat 12. Hard Rock Casino Resort. Andrew Tossie has made history. Nico Kulungu came out. He was a very game opponent. He looked very good coming out of Last Stand Fight Team, but he picks up the victory here tonight and becomes the first ever A1 Combat Amateur Champion. We're gonna check out the replays before we let Corey McKenna go. Here you see Tossie on top. He's got that right arm pinned, Corey McKenna. He's landing big shots.
Yeah, and he did a beautiful job here of going with the roll and like locking up that triangle. You know, he steps over the arm here, and as he turns, he actually goes with it. Kulungu didn't roll him here, he rolled with him. So he almost like let him feel like he was escaping, and he used that to lock up the triangle. He caused some damage to distract him, got the arm across, and that was all she wrote. So your first ever A1 amateur title holder will be Andrew Tossie.
Absolutely, guys. He has made history. And Garrett Fertig will announce the winner, and then we will move to UFC Fight Pass. Say goodbye to Corey McKenna, and hello to the California kid, Uriah Faber.
We need you guys up front.
Ladies and gentlemen, your prelim main event comes to a close at 1 minute 57 seconds of the third and final round, declaring your winner by submission due to a triangle choke. And now, the A1 Combat Amateur Bantamweight Champion, Andrew Tossie! Tosti.
Tosti makes history here tonight. Guys, make your way over to UFC Fight Pass. It's time for the pro show.
DJ, we need you to cut the music, please.